Recorded Books and One-Click Digital present The Conquering Tide, War in the Pacific Islands, 1942 to 1944, by Ian W. Toll. Narrated by P.J. Ochlan. Prologue. When aiming uncertainly for a landfall, somewhere in the blue immensity of the South Pacific, navigators watched for floating leaves or coconuts. They steered to follow seabirds overhead. They noted distant columns of thunderheads, which might be hovering over islands tucked beneath the horizon. They even lifted their noses and sniffed the breeze, because every so often, especially at night or in thick weather, land could be smelled before it could be seen. Nowhere was this more true than in the Solomons, an archipelago of fetid jungle islands a few degrees south of the equator, flung diagonally along a 500-mile axis between the Coral Sea and Bougainville Island. The larger islands of the Solomons gave off an aroma of damp soil and rotting vegetation that could travel 10 to 20 miles out to sea. To sailors on a ship approaching the source of that peculiar scent, the shoulders of the mountains loomed gradually out of the mist, even if the peaks remained hidden within impenetrable cloud caps. Plains and valleys, laid out in a patchwork of darker and lighter shades of green, spread beneath the mountains. Palm groves and mangrove swamps emerged along the shore. Finally, they spied the beach, a white horizontal border between the island's verdant overgrowth and the warm cerulean sea. The Solomons are dominated by a dozen large islands arranged in a double chain. Scattered among those mountainous landmasses are hundreds of small and mostly uninhabited islets or atolls, some rising barely 10 feet above sea level. The natural history of the region, which lies astride the southern arc of the Pacific Ring of Fire, has been fantastically violent. Subduction zones, where one part of the planet's crust is shoved under another and sea trenches plunge to depths of 20,000 feet or more, run parallel along the archipelago's northern and southern flanks. But the islands themselves, thrust up from the seabed by the same sorts of tectonic and volcanic forces, ascend to peaks of 5,000 to 7,000 feet. Mount Popomanasu on Guadalcanal, 7,661 feet above sea level, stands just 7 miles, as the crow flies, from the island's southern shore. If that same crow flew 10 more miles out to sea, it would cross the edge of the South Solomon Trench, which plunges to a depth of 17,500 feet. Only on the Ring of Fire do such extremes of ocean deeps and high peaks occur in such proximity. On the eve of the Second World War, the Solomons were home to about 100,000 dark-skinned Melanesians, the descendants of ancient nomadic peoples who had migrated from Asia across Pleistocene land bridges or navigated across the sea in hand-carved canoes. They lived much as they had in centuries or millennia past, in small villages and isolated tribal and family units, wearing little or nothing, scratching out a Neolithic subsistence by hunting, fishing, foraging, raising pigs, and tending small plots of taro and yams. They spoke about 100 different languages or dialects, which were, in many cases, so divergent as to be unintelligible even between neighboring tribes. Their lingua franca was a rough and ready derivative of English called pidgin, whose vocabulary ran to about 600 words. They did not share any sense of nationhood. They owed devotion only to their tribal kin, their ancestors, and their sacred places. Savage wars were recorded in their oral traditions. In the span of a few generations, history became legend. In the span of a few more, legend became myth. Young men, upon reaching a certain age, took up arms to settle their legendary and mythic blood feuds. Descending suddenly on rival tribes and villages, they killed, beheaded, and ate their enemies. Headhunting and cannibalism were rife throughout the 19th century, an era when the natives first came into regular contact with European seafarers. Unscrupulous whites practiced an illegal slave trade known as blackbirding, tricking or forcing natives aboard their ships to be transported to Australia, where they were put to work on cane plantations. The victims' tribesmen were inclined to retaliate against anyone who looked like the malefactors. A white man who went ashore thus risked being beheaded and roasted for a feast. Afterward, his severed head might be shrunken and kept by his killer as a souvenir. Before the British took control of the Solomons in 1893, vowing to put an end to blackbirding, headhunting, and cannibalism alike, the archipelago had earned a reputation as one of the most dangerous places on Earth. Putting aside for a moment the issues of self-determination, economic exploitation, and political legitimacy, history will show that half a century of colonial rule achieved a Pax Britannica in the Solomons. London governed the islands as a protectorate rather than a crown colony, asserting a relatively narrow authority over the affairs of its indigenous people. The islanders lived much as they had in the past, under the village authority of their tribal chiefs, headmen or big men, and according to their own inherited customs and laws. Rather than resorting to arms, the big men appealed to colonial officials to mediate their disputes, and were generally willing to be bound by the judgments rendered. A tribe running short of food could petition for relief, and would be fed or resettled in a place with arable land or fishing rights. It is impossible to know at this remove what proportion of the natives genuinely welcomed the British government, but by the 1930s, very few hated it enough to oppose it outright. Even in the earlier years of the Protectorate, organized revolts against British authority were scattered and short-lived. By 1941, there were none, and on most islands, no standing force was needed to maintain order. The Solomons natives were simply overawed by the whites, by their weapons, their ships, their technology, and perhaps most of all, their airplanes. Such unfathomable power lay beyond their ken. To think of opposing it was absurd. Better to acquiesce and make the best of it. Many islanders were fervently loyal to the British, and would have occasion to prove it in the impending Pacific War. The seat of colonial government was the somnambulant little island of Tulagi in the Ingela, or Florida, island group, 20 miles north of the much larger island of Guadalcanal. On Tulagi, 3 miles long and shaped like an hourglass, the British had assembled all the requisite trappings of colonial life: an officer's club, a barracks, a hotel, a stately official residence, a small golf course, a cricket pitch, a wireless station, and a waterfront with rudimentary seaport amenities. The larger outlying islands were divided into districts, and each district was administered by a district officer, D.O., generally a young, unmarried man on the first rung of a career in the British colonial service. The district officer had to brave primitive living conditions, suffocating heat, and recurring attacks of malaria. He lived alone, in a modest house on the coast, near the best natural harbor available. More often than not, his house doubled as the local government headquarters. His portfolio of responsibilities was very broad, but he had no staff other than the natives he recruited, trained, and employed. He was a governor, judge, police chief, coroner, tax collector, civil engineer, record keeper, harbor master, paymaster, and postmaster. All public funds were funneled through his hands, and he was expected to account for every penny in his official record books. He trudged from village to village on muddy jungle footpaths, or sailed a small wooden schooner along the coast, where most of the population was concentrated. The district officer, like every other typical white islander, was absolutely sure of his innate authority over the natives, who were, after all, only just down from the trees. The repugnant phrase, often heard in primitive outposts of the British Empire, put the colonialist rationale in a nutshell. But the British were well practiced in the arts of colonial oppression and shrewd enough to rule through rather than over the existing social order. The seasoned district officer made a show of consulting respectfully with the village big men, and he always deferred to local laws and customs when they did not collide with British authority. It was a minimalist government, but it was all that was needed. In the great game of imperial empires, the Solomons had never amounted to much. They were remote and inaccessible, even by the standards of the Pacific. They offered little in the way of trade or natural wealth. Few Europeans visited, and fewer could be induced to stay. In 1941, there were between 500 and 600 whites living in the entire archipelago, variously employed as plantation managers, shipping agents, traders, mining prospectors, storekeepers, doctors, colonial officers, and missionaries. Most looked forward to the day when their careers or economic fortunes would allow them to leave. The Solomons were a hardship post. The climate was sweltering and monsoonal. Rain-sodden jungles and mangrove swamps bred exotic fevers and skin disorders. Malaria, dengue fever, black water fever, dysentery, filariasis, clysentery, leprosy, elephantiasis, prickly heat, and trench foot. Crocodiles and leeches lurked in the rivers and swamps. Aggressive sharks patrolled the fringing reefs. Scorpions, spiders, centipedes, and snakes stung and bit. Knife-edged kunai grasses sliced into the flesh of those who walked through them. Cat-sized rats scurried through the jungle underbrush. The best view of the islands, said the old hands, was from the stern of a departing ship. Those were the Solomons in 1941, a marginal outpost of the British Empire, an economic and political backwater, a strategic non-entity, an afterthought. That was to change, suddenly and violently, in 1942. War arrived 6 weeks after Pearl Harbor, on the morning of January 22, 1942, when Japanese bombs first fell on Tulagi. The air attack was a bolt out of the blue. The British had not imagined that the Japanese would strike this far south and east, into the heart of the Lower Solomons, especially when Allied fleets and armies were still giving battle thousands of miles closer to Japan, in the Philippines, Malaya, and the Dutch East Indies. The following day, a Japanese amphibious force landed at Rabaul, an Australian-held seaport and advanced airbase on the island of New Britain, 650 miles northwest of Tulagi, and swiftly overran the 1,500-man garrison stationed there. The British had precious little military presence of any kind in the Solomons, so it was instantly apparent that the Japanese could swallow up the entire archipelago any time they liked. A similar pattern of conquest was unfolding throughout the Pacific. On December 7, 1941, Japan had launched a sea-air-land blitzkrieg across a vast front and advanced everywhere against feeble and confused Allied resistance. In every case, in Hawaii, the Philippines, Wake Island, Guam, Malaya, the Dutch East Indies, Hong Kong, Burma, New Britain, they delivered the initial blows from the air. Japanese carrier and land-based bombers struck suddenly and across unexpectedly long distances, pulverizing Allied airfields and naval bases and clearing the skies over landing beaches. Invasion forces followed in columns of troopships. Japanese infantry units went ashore and advanced quickly against poorly defended Allied airfields, often seizing them intact and without firing a shot. Japanese air groups flew into the captured airfields and prepared to stage the next round of attacks on positions farther south or east. When pockets of Allied resistance held out behind fortified lines, notably the joint American-Filipino forces on Bataan Peninsula and Corregidor Island in the Philippines, they were cut off and bypassed. By this rapid, tightly choreographed, leapfrogging pattern, the Japanese won an immense Pacific empire in little more than 4 months, while sustaining only token losses. Before December 1941, American and British aviation experts had arrogantly insisted that Japanese airplanes were poorly engineered knockoffs of Western technology, and Japanese pilots were laughably inept crash test dummies. These delusions were upended in the opening weeks of the war, when Allied air power throughout most of the theater was effectively wiped out. Only after the tide of conquest had washed over them did the Allies begin to understand that they had been duped. Playing cleverly on the hubris and racial chauvinism of their Western rivals, the Japanese had disguised the formidable power of their air fleets and airmen. The Imperial Japanese Navy was equipped with two very fine twin-engine medium bombers, the G3M, Allied codename Nell, and the G4M, Betty. Each could be configured to carry torpedoes or bombs with a payload capacity exceeding 1,700 pounds and a flying range of more than 2,000 nautical miles. They were often escorted by the Mitsubishi A6M-0, Japan's superb single-seat fighter plane, which had been designed to outclimb, outturn, and outmaneuver any other fighter aircraft of its era. Allied pilots who survived their initial dogfighting or tail-chasing contests with the Zero were staggered by the machine's capacity to turn sharply and climb away at high speed. Though it had been placed in service more than a year before the bombing of Pearl Harbor and had run up a high tally of easy victories against Chiang Kai-shek's air force in the skies over China, the Zero had remained virtually unknown in the West. Allied aviators had received no forewarning of its capabilities and no tactical advice in countering it, and therefore were forced to discover this strange acrobatic warplane in the unforgiving school of air combat. The British had staked their Asia-Pacific empire on their great naval and air base at Singapore, the Gibraltar of the East. But from the first day of the war, when a Japanese invasion force landed on the northeast coast of the Malay Peninsula and Japanese bombers battered Royal Air Force, RAF, aerodromes throughout the region, the Malayan campaign brought a relentless succession of one-sided Japanese victories in the air, on the land, and at sea. 3 days after Pearl Harbor, Japanese warplanes sank the battleship Prince of Wales and the battle cruiser Repulse off the Malayan coast, the first time in naval history that capital ships at sea had been destroyed by air attack. British commanders pulled their surviving aircraft back to Singapore, yielding the skies over northern Malaya to the enemy. Japanese army forces drove south with remarkable speed, routing British Commonwealth troops from their positions and sending them into disorderly retreat. The invaders combined raging frontal charges with flanking movements and infiltration tactics, in which small groups of lightly armed Japanese soldiers penetrated the jungles and mangrove swamps and attacked the British from behind. They leapfrogged down the coast by sea lifts in small craft. In the face of such a shrewd and agile enemy, and with Japanese aircraft attacking with impunity from overhead, the British lines were quick to abandon their positions and flee. As they joined up with other units farther south, or entered the island city of Singapore, they spread a terrifying new image of the enemy. The Japanese were super warriors, preternaturally endowed with superior fighting traits and an ability to live roughly off the land. They could not be defeated in the jungle, or evidently in the air or at sea. They must be invincible, and they were coming. Among many of the British and British Commonwealth troops, an attitude of despondency and resignation took hold. They were sullen and scornful of their officers, who had failed utterly to prepare for a foe they had so recently insisted on holding in contempt. Morale caved in on itself. From the wharves of Singapore, civilians began a panicked exodus, clamoring for passage on any departing ship. Officers finagled orders to be transferred to Java or anywhere else. A week after Japanese forces crossed the Johor Strait and entered Singapore, General Arthur Percival surrendered about 80,000 troops to a Japanese army less than half that size. With Singapore gone, the fate of the Dutch East Indies was preordained. An overmatched multinational Allied fleet was swiftly defeated in naval actions at the end of February, and remaining air and ground forces on Java were evacuated to Australia. Now, in the Solomons, a stampede of panicked white refugees poured south and east, hoping to find a ship to Australia. Colonial officials faced a similarly unmanageable state of affairs, except that in the Solomons, unlike in Malaya, there were no more than a handful of British troops in place to put up any resistance whatsoever. Protectorate officials did not pretend there was any realistic hope of stopping the next stage of the Japanese advance. The enemy would take the Solomons and eject the British, and months or perhaps years would pass before the Allies could return in force. The civilians of Tulagi and the adjoining islands packed up their belongings and fled. The resident commissioner, Britain's senior official in the islands, moved to Malaita, a large island farther east. Small schooners and cutters, usually under sail, carried evacuees from the northwest on the prevailing winds. A dilapidated coal steamer, the Morinda, made her last trip out of the Solomons in January. At the wharf on Gavutu, an island near Tulagi, a crowd of civilian refugees demanded to come aboard. After a near riot in which a doctor was injured, the captain took the terrified evacuees on board to be spirited away to Australia. By March 1942, most of the whites were gone from the Solomons, and civil order was crumbling. But the young district officers of the colonial service were told to remain and carry on with their jobs. The British government even arranged to have their applications for military service denied. Martin Clemens was one such man. He was a 26-year-old Scotsman, the son of an Aberdeen choirmaster, who had won scholarships to prestigious schools and graduated from Christ's College, Cambridge. Clemens had entered the colonial service in 1937, had been posted to the Solomons in 1938, and had served on two of the big jungle islands in the Solomons archipelago, San Cristobal and Malaita. He was a rugged man, mustachioed and square-jawed, but he was also a product of his era, his schooling, and the class-bound society in which he had been raised. His staunch companion was a little black dog of uncertain breed named Suinau. Fastidious in his dress and personal grooming, disciplined in his habits, and stoic in the face of danger, Clemens kept a meticulous and perceptive personal diary in which he quoted Shakespeare and punctuated his observations with modish exclamations such as "wizard" and "Kalu Calais." In the trying months of Japanese occupation, he would prove resourceful, courageous, and resilient. As the colonial administration cleared out of Tulagi, Clemens was ordered to take over the job of district officer on Guadalcanal. The island's administrative seat was at Aula, on the north shore, about 20 miles southeast of Tulagi, across the body of water that would later take the name Iron Bottom Sound. Here, Clemens moved into a modest white house built on wooden piles and thatched with palm leaves. Outside, amid frangipani and hibiscus plants and a small garden plot of yams and taro, he set up an observation platform at the top of a large banyan tree. A native scout was posted there throughout the daylight hours, watching for enemy airplanes. Tulagi and the RAF installations on nearby Gavutu and Tanambogo were bombed every morning, as regularly and predictably as a Tokyo train schedule. Big four-engine Kawanishi flying boats flew high overhead almost daily, and often doubled back at treetop altitude for a hard, close look at Clemens's house. One of Clemens's duties was to report these flights through a radio network known as the Coast Watching Service, an arm of the Royal Australian Navy, RAN. The Coast Watchers were first conceived as an informal, all-volunteer organization to provide early warning of enemy shipping and air movements. The Watchers were to radio their sighting reports to a receiver station in Townsville, on the northern coast of Australia. Each man was equipped with a Type 3B teleradio, a device that could send voice transmissions to a range of about 400 miles, or tapped code, Morse, to a range of about 600 miles. A specially cut crystal enabled the machines to transmit in the seldom-used 6 MHz frequency, chosen in the vain hope that Japanese eavesdroppers might miss the transmissions. The greatest drawback to the apparatus was its size. It included more than a dozen separate elements, including a receiver, a transmitter, antennae, a loudspeaker, a set of aerials, and a large supply of spare parts. It was powered by a pair of heavy 6-volt automobile batteries that had to be recharged frequently, requiring a gasoline generator and a fuel supply. Clemens made his transmissions each day. He also listened to the broadcasts of other coast watchers on islands up the Solomon's Chain, who recorded the relentless progress of Japanese forces as they swept down from the northwest. Positions fell, garrisons were routed, and coast watchers snuck into the jungle interior. The Japanese pushed into Buka Passage, north of Bougainville, forcing the small RAF detachment there to scatter into the bush. On April 5th, a surprise landing at Kangu Beach, on southern Bougainville, forced coast watching station DMK at Buin off the air. In the following week, the Japanese expanded their grip on the area around Buin and seized nearby Shortland Island. Clemens tried to maintain civil order on Guadalcanal, but he could not be everywhere at once, and the abandoned plantations were looted and vandalized by natives and white refugees. He arrested looters, took witness testimony, and removed abandoned supplies to secure government storehouses. Much of his time was consumed in arranging food, shelter, and ship passage for groups of refugees, or repatriating native workers from other islands who had been idled by the abandonment of the plantations. That the white inhabitants of the islands were fleeing in panic could not be concealed from the natives, who told one another, "All together, Japan e come." The tribal big men traveled to Aola from villages all over the island and put their questions to Clemens. Why were most of the whites falling all over themselves to escape the island? What would become of their villages under Japanese occupation? In his memoir, Clemens recounted his speech, in Pidgin, to a delegation of chiefs in March 1942. "No matter altogether Japan e come, me stop long you fella. Business belong you fella boil 'em all e way. By and by, altogether belong me fella come save 'em you me. Me no savvy who, me no savvy when, but by and by everything e all right. Even if the Japanese come in strength, I will stay here with you. Stick with me, and eventually the Allies will return and save us from the enemy. I don't know who will come or when, but we'll all be fine in the end." Clemens recalled that he had made the promise with a sinking heart, but the chiefs appeared to accept it. In early April, Clemens sailed his schooner to the northwestern tip of Guadalcanal to pay a visit to a plantation manager named F. Ashton Snowy Rhodes. Rhodes, a hardy, stubbornly independent Australian, had watched the exodus of most of the island's other white residents with imperious disgust and refused to join it. He had nothing but contempt for the British colonial government, which, he wrote in his diary, had simply collapsed. From his house high on a cliff at Lavoro, he commanded a broad vista of the sea and sky to the west, the direction from which Japanese ships and planes must come. Clemens convinced Rhodes to join the coast-watching network and set him up with a teleradio. On April 29th, Allied patrol aircraft spotted a Japanese fleet moving down from the Upper Solomons. 2 days later, Clemens watched the heaviest bombing raid yet on Tulagi. On May 2nd, coast watchers on Santa Isabel reported observing a Japanese seaplane carrier in a bay off the northwestern end of the island, just 150 miles from Tulagi. With that clear evidence of an impending invasion, the Royal Australian Air Force, RAAF, detachment on Tanambogo, where there were just four seaplanes and a small garrison, announced their withdrawal in anticipation of an enemy landing. They navigated an old steamer across the sound to Aola, towing a damaged Catalina seaplane, which they placed in Clemens's care. Clemens recruited several hundred natives to haul the aircraft up the beach and hide it under palm leaves. At dawn on May 3rd, a small Japanese fleet sailed into Tulagi Harbor. Troops went ashore to find the British government gone and the island largely deserted. Clemens immediately arranged to have the damaged Catalina towed out into the sound and scuttled. The morning of May 4th brought a stirring plot twist, as a large formation of strange planes appeared overhead at 0800. They had not come from the northwest, the direction of enemy air bases at Rabaul and at Buka Island, but from the south. The strangers were carrier bombers and fighters of the U.S. aircraft carrier Yorktown, and their surprise airstrike on the Japanese ships anchored off Tulagi was the opening blow in the four-day Battle of the Coral Sea, May 4th to 8th, 1942. Snowy Rhodes wrote that he was startled to hear a great droning overhead and saw, to my amazement, 20 or 30 single-engine planes flying in a course direct to Tulagi. These planes were only a few hundred feet up, and I could plainly see stars on their wings. Clemens was thrilled by the magnificent spectacle of 12 dive bombers plunging down out of the clouds over Tulagi. What a sight for sore eyes. Having expended their bombs and torpedoes, the intruders disappeared back to the south, over the mountainous spine of Guadalcanal. Clemens's position was precarious. The American planes had come and gone, and they had not dislodged the Japanese forces from Tulagi. His house was a stone's throw from the beach, and the Japanese might descend on him at any moment. On May 5th, Clemens was on the beach at Aola when three Kawanishis suddenly roared low over his head. A few days later, another Australian coast watcher on Bougainville reported that a large Japanese fleet was rendezvousing at Queen Carola Harbor off Buka. For me, the issues now were clear, Clemens observed. Here we were at Aola, and there were the Japs at Tulagi, less than 20 miles away. The enemy was more likely to come to Aola than to any other part of the coast, as they would know, from the natives they had interrogated, that it was the British administrative headquarters for all of Guadalcanal. If captured, Clemens could look forward to being tortured and forced to reveal all he knew. Snowy Rhodes, at Lavoro on the far northwestern tip of the island, was in a similarly worrying fix. Japanese patrol planes flew low over his house nearly every day. Feeling himself as public as a goldfish, he hid in a hole covered by palm fronds whenever he heard the approaching engines. He noted in his diary, "I realized that the war had now come to us at last, and that I was nothing else but a civilian spy, and if caught, would be treated accordingly." Like all the continental islands of the Solomons, Guadalcanal was large and almost entirely undeveloped. Roads were unknown except on the plantations. Inland travel was done on foot, by muddy jungle trails or on stream beds. Beyond the coastal plains lay a vast, unmapped, undulating jungle landscape. The best-traveled footpaths led up knife-edge mountain ridges separated by deep ravines. A man could hide almost anywhere, concealed in the lowering jungle, and a passing column of enemy soldiers would never detect his presence. There was much to do, and little time to do it. Supplies, provisions, weapons, ammunition, and fuel cans had to be packed up and carried away to secret jungle caches. Nothing should be left behind that the enemy might find valuable. Everything had to be either taken or destroyed. There was an awful lot to do and little time to think, said Clemens. Things were happening very fast, and the position was very grim. I was pinned to the beach by the teleradio, yet I would have to get everything hidden away in the bush quick and lively, as a fast launch would take only 2 hours to come from Tulagi. Clemens ran a native constabulary, manned by trustworthy men. But he was also required to employ hundreds of others as laborers and carriers, and for every one native he employed, there were perhaps 10 more who knew where he was going and what he was doing. Could he trust them? Even if he was not directly betrayed to the Japanese, could the native carriers be trusted not to plunder the secret supply caches? In late May, Clemens and Rhodes learned that a native named George Bogies, who had worked as a medical practitioner on Savo Island, was cooperating with the Japanese. The news sent a shudder up their spines, because Bogies knew them personally and could give the enemy a great deal of information. On May 19th, feeling that he had already lingered too long, Clemens left Aola, leading a long cavalcade of heavily burdened carriers. 16 men were needed to carry the teleradio and its many component parts, which altogether weighed almost 300 pounds. Others carried vital government records, weapons, food, fuel, even his office safe, with some 800 pounds in silver coinage. Their path led up through grassy plains to a region of steeply ascending red clay hills. At dusk, they stopped, exhausted, at a little village named Palapau. Clemens moved into a small leaf hut that would double as his office and residence, and began at once to reassemble the teleradio. He strung the aerial between two trees and arranged vines to conceal it from the air. Workers began building an observation platform on one of the highest trees in the village. A native sentry would stand watch through the daylight hours, with orders to blow a note on a conch shell should the Japanese land on the beach several miles below. Clemens's retreat was timely. The first small Japanese scouting parties arrived on Guadalcanal a week later. When questioned, the local natives pleaded ignorance of the whereabouts of any white men, replying, "Me no savvy," or "Altogether go finish." On June 8th, a larger force of Japanese troops came ashore and set up a tent camp on the plains near the Lunga River. 10 days later, a Japanese destroyer anchored a few hundred feet off the mouth of the Lunga and began unloading supplies on the beach. Clemens noted in his diary entry of June 20th, "It looks as if the Nips are here to stay." Clemens had his trusted constables walk down to Lunga to gather information. The Japanese appeared to be building a wharf and were certainly burning fields on Lunga Plantation. That suggested they might be laying the groundwork for an airstrip, and Clemens promptly reported the intelligence to Townsville, where it was relayed to the Navy office in Melbourne, and from there, to the Allied High Command in Washington and London. In the first week of July, a 12-ship convoy came down to Savo Sound and anchored off the new wharf. Heavy construction equipment and trucks came ashore, with several hundred more troops and laborers. That removed all doubt. The Japanese were building an airstrip on Guadalcanal, and if they were permitted to finish it, they would extend their air search capabilities deep into the Coral Sea. Clemens also learned from his scouts that the Japanese had asked after him by name. They had evidently intercepted some of his transmissions. Might they pinpoint his position using radio direction-finding gear? The natives also reported that the Japanese were planning to track him with bloodhounds. "That was cheerful news," Clemens dryly observed. Palapau, remote as it was no longer safe. On July 4th, Clemens moved again, farther up and back into the hills, to a tiny, impoverished village called Vungana. The trail went up a muddy ridge, with the land falling away steeply on either side. Clemens climbed the more treacherous sections with Suinau, his little dog, clutched under one arm. He watched in trepidation as the barefoot carriers struggled under the weight of his equipment. And I died 1,000 deaths as I watched the battery carriers, who had to give up pole and sling, holding a heavy battery on their shoulder with one hand while trying to stop themselves from falling with the other. Vungana amounted to a half dozen thatched huts on a narrow spur of land, but it was so high in the foothills that it was probably safe from the Japanese, at least for the moment. From that altitude, more than 1,500 feet above sea level, Clemens commanded a magnificent view of the Lunga airfield and the entire sound, and could closely observe the shipping movements between Tulagi and Guadalcanal. Again, he set up his teleradio, stringing the aerial between two large green bamboo trees. But the apparatus was becoming increasingly bulky. It was not designed for portability, and the humidity seemed to have eaten away at its internal circuitry. Clemens found it necessary to open the case and allow the mechanism to dry in the sun all afternoon before attempting to transmit in the early evening. July was the darkest period of the war for Clemens. The nights were cold at that altitude, and he could barely sleep. His reserves of food, money, fuel, and spare parts were running short. Even fresh water had to be carried up to the village from a stream several hundred feet below. His native scouts reported that Japanese troops were spreading out, searching along the coast and up the rivers, closely interrogating the missionaries who had remained behind. On July 8th, Clemens radioed Townsville to report that 700 Japanese troops were bivouacked in tents on the plains below. The Scotsman added that he was not sure how much longer he could hold out. The radio's charging engine was increasingly difficult to start, and it seemed only a matter of time before the radio would fail for good. His native workers were hungry, and if he could not feed them, he could not expect them to stay. On the morning of July 26th, Clemens was surprised by a sudden appearance of a Kawanishi over Vungana, just a few hundred feet above his head. He dived for cover and concealed himself just as the aircraft banked sharply and came back around for a closer look. He had to assume he had been spotted. Clemens gave serious consideration to attempting the grueling and dangerous overland trek to the southern, weather coast of Guadalcanal, in hopes of finding a hidden boat that could carry him to Australia. Cryptic radio message from Townsville asked precise questions. What was the exact location of the Japanese wireless station? The type and number of troops? The placement and caliber of their artillery pieces? Were any aircraft on the island? These queries fired Clemens's hopes, because they seemed to presage an operation of some kind, possibly an airstrike. Naturally, the men on the other side of the radio link could tell him nothing, but they hinted that deliverance was imminent. It won't be long now. So he waited, agonized, and lost weight. The more I looked, the more impossible the situation seemed to be. With my charging engine working only intermittently, it was a struggle just to get out the traffic, let alone consult others as to what should be done. On August 6th, a scout returned from the coast to report that the airfield at Lunga had been rolled with gravel and dirt and appeared ready to receive aircraft. A hangar was under construction near the airstrip. Japanese troops on the island now numbered approximately 4,000. Clemens radioed the new intelligence and asked whether the Allies would attempt to destroy the airfield. No answer came. "All I could taste was the bitterness of defeat," he wrote. He went to bed early, his stomach empty, and descended into a deep slumber. Wrenched awake by the shock and rumble of artillery, Clemens checked his watch. It was 6:13 a.m. and still dark. Heavy naval guns were firing in Tsavo Sound. What ships? Whose ships? An excited scout reported that the entire Japanese Navy was anchored in Lunga, and for a moment, Clemens recalled, "My heart stood still." In another few minutes, his ears pricked up at the drone of airplanes overhead. Tuning the radio, he tried different frequencies until he heard American-accented voices describing a panorama of destruction along the coast. He noted references to Orange Base, Black Base, and Red Base. Three aircraft carriers. Wizard, he wrote in his diary. Kalu Calais, oh what a day. As dawn broke, Clemens swept the sound with his binoculars. He counted more than 50 ships, including several heavy cruisers that were raining 8-inch projectiles down on Japanese installations around Lunga Point. Buildings and fuel dumps blazed fiercely and discharged huge columns of oily black smoke. Green-clad troops descended from transports into landing boats, which then motored in toward beaches west of Lunga. It was the largest amphibious landing that Clemens, or anyone else, had ever witnessed. His teleradio was failing rapidly, the inevitable result of rough handling and humidity. But Martin Clemens did not need a radio to tell him the Yanks had come to stay. From Umi Yukaba, across the sea, anthem of the Imperial Japanese Navy. Across the sea, water-drenched corpses. Across the mountains, grass-covered corpses. We shall die by the side of our emperor. We shall never look back. From Psalm 23. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Chapter 1. Henry L. Stimson, the veteran Republican statesman who served as Franklin Delano Roosevelt's Secretary of War, left a well-aimed barb in his post-war memoir. Recounting the bitter rivalry between the Army and the Navy, a struggle for influence and resources that colored every phase of the Pacific War, Stimson thought the trouble grew mainly from the peculiar psychology of the Navy Department, which frequently seemed to retire from the realm of logic into a dim religious world in which Neptune was God, Mahan his prophet, and the United States Navy the only true church. A Navy partisan would not lack for ripostes. The messianic fantasies of General Douglas MacArthur come quickly to mind. But Stimson's characterization should not be too lightly dismissed. During past eras of peace, the Navy had tended to become insular, inward-looking, and parochial. Every flag officer, admiral, had passed through the same way stations: Annapolis, the Naval War College, a series of commands ashore and at sea. Whereas the Army's wartime chief of staff, General George C. Marshall, had attended Virginia Military Institute, VMI, rather than West Point, there was not an admiral in the Navy who had not graduated from the Naval Academy. Every senior naval commander had lived his entire adult life in the Navy, beginning at the tender age of 17 or 18. He had been steeped in the sea power doctrines of Alfred Thayer Mahan, the eminent naval historian and strategic theorist. He had been taught to revere the heritage and traditions of the institution, to owe it his fierce and undying allegiance. The Navy, first, last, and always. Inter-service enmity was not a specifically American predicament. Indeed, it was far more impassioned in Japan, where the generals and admirals regarded one another as virtual enemies, and a deadlock between them had been at the heart of that nation's reckless lurch into a calamitous war. But the American military leadership, thrust unexpectedly into war in 1941, was largely unprepared to function in an integrated high command. The Army and Navy had interacted very little in peacetime and had neglected the challenges of planning and executing joint operations. Until 1947, there was no such thing as a Department of Defense or a Secretary of Defense. The Navy and War Departments were independent and co-equal, each headed by a civilian cabinet secretary who reported directly to the president. Before December 1941, there was no such thing as a Joint Chiefs of Staff, JCS. That body was convened as an ad hoc committee for the first wartime summit with the British. With no other mechanism on hand for inter-service cooperation, the JCS continued to meet regularly for the duration of the war, but it functioned without formal statutory authority and without an official chairman. Admiral Ernest J. King, the highest-ranking officer in the Navy, was not subordinate to Marshall, or vice versa. The military chiefs either muddled toward a consensus or were obliged to appeal their disputes to President Roosevelt. The acrimony was found at every rank. Vicious brawls erupted nightly between sailors, Marines, and soldiers on the streets of San Francisco and Honolulu. Sailors and soldiers taunted one another as swabbies and dog faces and settled the issue with their fists. Infantrymen begrudged sailors their hot meals and clean bunks, amenities that seemed criminally lavish when compared to the squalor and privations of war on land. The bad feeling between sailors and Marines had been notorious since the founding of both services during the American Revolution. Insults crept into the padding inserted at the beginning and end of encrypted radio messages. For example, U.S. Marine Corps, seagoing bellhops, yeah, yeah, yeah. On naval bases across the world, guardhouses and gates were manned by scowling Marines whose customary hail to all sailors was, "Where in the hell do you think you're going?" Senior Army officers regarded the entire Marine Corps as a plot hatched by the Navy to usurp their rightful function, and did their best to asphyxiate it, or at least limit its deployments to units no larger than a regiment. Naval aviators grumbled that the Army Air Forces, USAF, handed out medals like after-dinner mints. Pilots of different services took satisfaction in buzzing a rival's airfields or aircraft, or, when on the ground, holding down their brakes while gunning their engines in order to blow clouds of dirt or dust onto their adversaries. Every major action early in the Pacific War involved a dimension of inter-service rancor. After the attack on Pearl Harbor, Navy Secretary Frank Knox often stressed that the Army had been assigned primary responsibility for the air defense of Oahu. After the spirited and ultimately futile defense of Wake Island, Navy and Marine public relations offices vied for public acclaim. MacArthur declared that the fall of the Philippines was due fundamentally to a lack of sea power in the Pacific. The Doolittle Raid, an operation in which Army B-25 bombers were launched from an aircraft carrier to strike Japan in April 1942, was a rare successful example of cooperation between Army and Naval air units. But Colonel James H. Doolittle's airmen later faulted Admiral William F. Halsey, Jr. for ordering them to launch too early, when the task force was still nearly 700 miles from Japan. At the Battle of the Coral Sea, May 4th to 8th, 1942, MacArthur's Australian-based USAF planes were blamed for inaccurate sighting reports and for dropping bombs on units of the Allied fleet, having mistaken them for Japanese ships. All fell harmlessly into the sea. At the Battle of Midway, June 4th to 6th, 1942, Navy dive bombers flying from the Enterprise in Yorktown attacked and destroyed four of Japan's finest and largest aircraft carriers. But initial press reports mistakenly credited Army B-17s flying from airfields on Midway. "Big Bombers Won" was the front page headline in the New York Times on June 12, 1942. Brigadier General Willis H. Hale announced that the Battle of Midway was primarily won in the blasting by flying fortresses of a Japanese naval task force, including carriers, off the island on the morning of June 4th. History would eventually determine that no bomb dropped by any Army plane had struck any Japanese ship. But in the immediate aftermath of the victory, the B-17 crews returned first to Honolulu and regaled news correspondents with their claims of spectacular and numerous hits on the enemy fleet. Navy pilots who knew what had really happened were incensed. When aviators of the two services came face-to-face at the Moana Hotel in Honolulu a week after the battle, arguments escalated into fistfights. Ensign Fred Mears, a Hornet torpedo pilot, noted that the Navy aviators had seen their friends risk and sometimes lose their lives going below 1,000 feet to dive bomb, torpedo, and sink Jap warships, while the Army stayed at a safe 20,000 feet and not only missed, but sometimes dropped on our own craft. That's why they got mad at the Army. Marine General Holland M. Howlin' Mad Smith, in a score-settling post-war memoir, indicted the Navy for mental arteriosclerosis. He cited a range of offenses. The Navy had failed to provide enough gunfire and aviation support in amphibious operations. It had forced the Marines to make do with second-rate, cast-off, obsolete equipment and weaponry. Admirals in offshore task forces had interfered with Marine commanders' authority on the beachheads. Smith's umbrage was shared by men down the ranks. Marine infantrymen, carried to enemy beaches in Navy transports, took offense at injustices large and small. Their memoirs and oral histories are rife with grievances, accounts of unequal mess privileges and berthing arrangements, of being denied the right to purchase candy or cigarettes at the ship's store, of leaving their personal effects in care of the Navy and never seeing them again, of being barricaded in the lower decks and cut off from fresh air or sunshine, of being forced to abide by ridiculous rules for the safety of the ship. Marines left a sardonic note for the crew of a Navy transport that had brought them to Peleliu, site of one of the bloodiest amphibious assaults of the war. "It gives us great pleasure at this time to extend our sincere thanks to all members of the crew for their kind and considerate treatment of Marines during this cruise. We non-combatants realize that the brave and stalwart members of the crew are winning the war in the Pacific. You Navy people even go within 10 miles of a Japanese island, thereby risking your precious lives. Oh, how courageous you are." More than any other type of military operation, amphibious warfare, striking an enemy on land by way of sea, exposed and aggravated the frictions between the services. The Pacific War was the largest, bloodiest, most costly, most technically innovative, and most logistically complex amphibious war in history. To roll back the tide of Japanese conquests, the Allies would be required to seize one island after another, advancing across thousands of miles of ocean in two huge parallel offensives on either side of the equator. The Army, Navy, and Marines were compelled to work together in sustained and intricate cooperation. They would make many mistakes and do their best to learn from them. But even when their operations were successful, the inter-service feuding left scars that even victory could not heal. On June 13th, having learned of the American victory at the Battle of Midway, British Prime Minister Winston Churchill cabled Roosevelt, "This is the moment for me to send you my heartiest congratulations on the grand American victories in the Pacific, which have very decidedly altered the balance of the naval war. All good wishes to you and friends." Even in a routine congratulatory telegram, Churchill chose his words carefully. The battle had altered the balance of the Pacific War. It had not turned the tide. The Imperial Japanese Navy had lost the carriers Hiryu, Soryu, Kaga, and Akagi with all of their aircraft, and more than 3,000 veteran officers, sailors, and airmen had been killed in action. Even so, Japan retained a numerical advantage in most categories of deployed naval and air strength. The combined fleet could still muster 5 aircraft carriers to the Americans' 4, and had several more under construction. Except for the cruiser Mikuma, destroyed in mopping up operations 2 days after the sinking of the 4 carriers, Japan's surface naval forces were intact. Midway had claimed none of Japan's redoubtable battleships, submarines, destroyers, troopships, or flying boats, or any of its potent land-based medium bombers. All but about 110 of Japan's veteran carrier aviators survived the battle, even while losing their planes, and ample numbers of replacement aircraft were still coming off the assembly lines in Nagoya, Yokosuka, Musashino, and Kure. Midway hardly diminished the violence or energy of the Japanese offensive in the South Pacific, where naval, ground, and air forces based at Rabaul on New Britain Island were pushing south and east and keeping local Allied forces on a tenuous defensive. 2 weeks after Midway, Admiral King traveled from Washington to Annapolis to address the 611 midshipmen of the Naval Academy's class of 1942. Theirs was the largest class in the Academy's 97-year history. The class was being graduated a year early, their course of study having been cut to 3 years from 4, to feed the expanding fleet's demand for new officers. Standing behind a rostrum in Dahlgren Hall, the Admiral warned the young men that they were to be thrown into the greatest war in history, and that the effort would require unremitting labor and a multitude of heartaches and sacrifices such as this country has never before known. King was the most powerful admiral in American history, the first to occupy simultaneously the 2 most powerful posts in the service, those of Commander-in-Chief of the U.S. Fleet, Cominch, and Chief of Naval Operations, CNO. A tall, dark-haired man with a narrow face and sharply cleft chin, he was unusual among his colleagues in having risen from working-class origins. He had been born and raised in Lorain, Ohio, where his father had worked as a foreman at a railroad machine shop. King was more respected than liked by his colleagues. Disdaining the tradition of clubby collegiality that bound Annapolis graduates to one another, he had made it his personal business to rid the service of men he regarded as indolent or inept. The admiral, according to an aide, would tolerate almost anything in an officer except incompetence, laziness, or verbosity. King was direct to the point of obnoxiousness, and he did not bother to conceal his contempt for those who opposed him. General Marshall remarked after the war, "I had trouble with King because he was always sore at everybody. He was perpetually mean." In his private wartime diary, General Dwight D. Eisenhower wrote in the same vein, but less delicately. "One thing that might help win this war is to get someone to shoot King. He's the antithesis of cooperation, a deliberately rude person, which means he's a mental bully." The British military chiefs tended to suspect King of conspiring to divert forces from Europe to the Pacific. General Sir Alan Brooke, chief of the British Imperial General Staff, noted in his diary during the Casablanca Conference in early 1943, "King is a shrewd and somewhat swollen-headed individual. His vision is mainly limited to the Pacific, and any operation calculated to distract from the force available in the Pacific does not meet with his support or approval. He does not approach the problem with a worldwide war point of view, but instead with one biased entirely in favor of the Pacific. Although he pays lip service to the fundamental policy that we must first defeat Germany and then turn on Japan, he fails to apply it in any problems connected with the war." The truth was more nuanced. King never questioned the strategic wisdom of Europe First, the Allies' plan, agreed to in early 1941, reaffirmed after the attack on Pearl Harbor, to direct the lion's share of their collective effort against Germany. The German Wehrmacht was engaged on the Eastern Front in the most cataclysmic ground war ever waged. Should it prevail, forcing a Russian surrender or collapse, Hitler could redeploy 100 divisions or more to Western Europe. Conversely, if Germany could be overpowered, the defeat of Japan and Italy must inevitably follow. But the Europe First, or Germany First, policy, stated in the abstract, left a host of subsidiary questions unresolved. If the Pacific theater was to receive a lesser share of Allied strength, what exactly should that proportion be? 10%? Or something closer to 30%? What did it mean to hold against an enemy that could attack anywhere across a vast ocean front? There were no foxholes at sea, no trenches or defensive fortifications. Even after its reverse at Midway, Japan posed a threat to Allied territories throughout the South Pacific, and until the theater could be stabilized, there was no prospect of the hypothetical holding action pictured in Allied planning documents. The danger was imminent, and the need to counter it, imperative. In the spring of 1942, King had pressed his colleagues to reinforce the sea route between North America and Australia. Acknowledging the scarcity of Allied troops, as well as shipping and military assets of every kind, with the unavoidable upshot that his plans might hinder the campaign against Germany, King told the other joint chiefs that the South Pacific emergency was certainly the more urgent. It must be faced now. Quite apart from any idea of future advance in this theater, we must see to it that we are actually able to maintain our present positions. He repeatedly steered discussions back to the need for strong points, particularly in Samoa, Fiji, New Caledonia, New Hebrides, and Tonga. Those islands could be held only with concentrated reinforcements of garrison troops, aircraft, and labor and equipment for airfield construction. On May 12th, King asked Marshall to transfer at least 3 Army bomber groups, with ground crews, spare parts, fuel, and ammunition, from Australia and Hawaii to New Caledonia, Efate, and Fiji. As always, however, King would not be satisfied with a purely static defense. When enough force was concentrated into this network of South Pacific strong points, the Allies should launch a more ambitious program, a northwest counteroffensive, staged from bases in the New Hebrides into the Solomons and the Bismarck Archipelago, after the same fashion of step-by-step advances that the Japanese used in the South China Sea. On June 24th, he cabled an early warning of his contemplated offensive to Admiral Chester W. Nimitz, Commander-in-Chief of the Pacific Fleet, SINCPAC. Nimitz should muster naval and air forces for the seizure and initial occupation of Tulagi and adjacent islands. The following day, King added that the offensive would begin about August 1st. 5 weeks to launch the biggest amphibious assault since Gallipoli. In one of the most primitive and inaccessible theaters of the war. For the past several months, King had been lobbying the Joint Chiefs and the White House for a Solomon's offensive, but he had never intimated that it could be launched as early as August. The timetable seemed implausibly premature. Command responsibility would fall to Admiral Robert L. Gormley, the newly appointed commander of South Pacific Forces, COMSOPAC. But Gormley had arrived in the theater only 5 weeks earlier, and his was an entirely new command. He was camped for the moment in Auckland, New Zealand, but he had not yet pulled together a staff or established a permanent headquarters. Immersed in the complexities of logistics, the COMSOPAC was not yet even receiving timely communications because of inexperienced radio and coding personnel. Uppermost in Gormley's mind was the problem of fuel. Chartered tankers had been dispatched from North America with 500,000 barrels of oil, and he would have 3 fleet oilers assigned for underway replenishment. He had small dry docks at Auckland and Wellington on New Zealand's North Island, but any major damage to larger ships would have to be handled in Pearl Harbor or North America. He had no facilities for bulk fuel storage north of New Zealand. Ammunition of every category and caliber was in dangerously short supply. The South Pacific Air Commander, Rear Admiral John S. Slew McCain, Com Air SOPAC, was engaged in the Sisyphean tribulations of building airstrips on remote tropical islands, offering nothing in the way of raw materials but coconuts and native timber. The troops that would actually land in the Solomons, the 1st Marine Division, under Major General Alexander Archer Vandegrift, had left their training base at New River, North Carolina, less than a month earlier. 2/3 of those forces were still at sea, en route to New Zealand. They had been promised an additional 6 months' training before being deployed in active operations, and had not yet set in motion the colossal logistical preparations an amphibious landing would require. Operation Pestilence, the codename assigned to this first attempt to wrest territory from the Japanese, would quickly fall to pieces unless supported by well-appointed sea and air bases in the island groups immediately east of the Solomons. With King's deadline just 5 weeks away, those bases did not yet exist. Noumea, capital of the Free French colony of New Caledonia, offered a serviceable airfield and a capacious harbor with rudimentary port facilities. But it was 986 miles southeast of Guadalcanal, far too distant to provide direct air support. Farther north, in the southern New Hebrides, the island of Ifate had been occupied by a marine battalion, and construction was underway on a fighter airstrip. But Ifate was 800 miles southeast of Guadalcanal, still too far to serve the purpose. A sea base and airstrip were needed in the remote northern reaches of the New Hebrides, within a 650-mile flight radius of Guadalcanal. Scouting the area from the air, Admiral McCain peered down at the island of Espiritu Santo, the largest in the group, and spotted a heavily forested plain nestled amid hilly jungle terrain. It was just inland of Segon Channel, a fine natural harbor. It would have to do. Captain M.B. Gardner, McCain's chief of staff, later told a panel of officers in Washington, "Robinson Crusoe should be required reading for anyone who is setting up an advanced base in the South Pacific Islands. There is nothing to start with except the jungle." The frenetic month-long race to hack a 6,000-foot bomber strip out of the jungle at Button, the codename for Espiritu Santo, exposed the scale of the challenges encountered by the construction battalions, Seabees, in the South Pacific. All necessary equipment and supplies were brought into Segon Channel by ship, but there were no wharves, warehouses, or cranes in the harbor, and all heavy equipment had to be hauled onto the beach from pontoon lighters. Fuel drums were pushed off the decks and swum into the beaches, then lifted manually onto trucks to be dispersed to more than 2 dozen concealed fuel dumps. Marston mats, the pierced steel planking used to surface runways, came in monstrous 2.5-ton bundles that had to be run up the beaches in tank lighters. When the destroyer USS Dale arrived at Santo on July 28th, her crew had expected a proper naval base, but for several hours, they could not even find the anchorage. "We couldn't figure out where to go, so we just cruised slowly around the island. Finally, the lookout spotted some mastheads sticking up above some palm trees, and we rounded a point to find an entrance to a little bay." The primeval conditions required manpower, and plenty of it, but manpower, in turn, created its own logistical problems. All provisions, clothing, and medical supplies had to be brought in directly from the United States, and the prevalence of malaria called for Quonset huts, or at least screened tent cabins. For a month, 35 CB equipment operators and a company of African-American labor troops did battle with the jungle. They worked around the clock, under floodlights at night. The CBs ran the tractors, bulldozers, and rollers, and the infantrymen wielded axes and shovels. Trucks and earth-moving equipment were often idled for lack of a single minor part, and a seaplane had to be dispatched to Efate or Noumea to obtain it. With a desperate spasm of effort, the work was completed on July 28th, the deadline McCain had ordered. The first squadron of B-17s flew in the next day, but they had to be fueled manually, and each of the big four-engine bombers drank 50 drums of fuel. Almost a year would pass before the base could be equipped with bulk aviation gasoline storage tanks and a pipeline to the harbor. Seaplanes could operate out of Segon Channel, but there was no seaplane tender available until the end of July. The harbor was unprotected by either mines or torpedo nets. The construction teams had worked themselves to exhaustion. They were full of malaria and need rest. The Wakefield, a once sumptuous luxury liner now doing service as a squalid and overcrowded troop transport, passed through the heads of Wellington Harbor, New Zealand, on June 14th. She carried General Vandegrift, most of his staff, and the first echelon of the 1st Marine Division. The voyage had been grueling. The Wakefield was under-provisioned, requiring the men to manage on short rations. Many had lost 15 to 20 pounds at sea. Vandegrift had counted on a period of rest and recuperation, followed by an additional 6 months' training in New Zealand. But on June 26th, at a conference with Admiral Gormley in Auckland, the Admiral wordlessly handed him King's June 24th dispatch to Nimitz, warning of pending orders for an amphibious attack in the Solomons, with D-Day set for August 1st. Vandegrift was dumbfounded. "I could not believe it," he recalled. "I read the typewritten words again. There was no mistaking their content." Most of the Marines of the 1st Division had enlisted immediately after Pearl Harbor. They had received little or nothing in the way of amphibious training. Two-thirds of the division was in Samoa or still at sea. Operation Watchtower, codename for the first stage of pestilence, the capture of Tulagi and Guadalcanal, would throw those new Marines into an assault on enemy-held islands in just 5 weeks' time. Insofar as Vandegrift knew, the beaches would be fortified and defended by the same battle-tested veterans who had routed the British in Malaya and the Dutch in the East Indies. His equipment, weaponry, and supplies were crated in the holds of 7 transports. All had to be unloaded, reclassified, and combat-loaded onto smaller assault transports, a colossal logistics problem that alone might require a month or more to solve. Vandegrift did not believe the operation was feasible, certainly not by August 1st. Gormley was even more pessimistic. "I don't see how we can land at all, and I am going to take it up with MacArthur." King's dispatch had not come in the form of an affirmative order. Rather, the Comanche had written that the following arrangements are contemplated, and Nimitz should prepare accordingly. King was maneuvering to force the operation through the Joint Chiefs over the objections of MacArthur, who wanted to command it himself. After several rounds of heated argument, followed by some hard bargaining, Marshall agreed to a 3-phase offensive through the Solomons and New Guinea, concluding with the capture of Rabaul. The orders were distributed on July 2nd. Task 1, the seizure and occupation of Santa Cruz Islands, Tulagi and adjacent positions, would remain under the command authority of Nimitz and his sub-theater commander, Admiral Gormley. King subsequently altered adjacent positions to specify the island of Guadalcanal. Tasks 2 and 3, involving the capture of Japanese airfields on the northeast coast of New Guinea, followed by the seizure and occupation of Rabaul, would be General MacArthur's show. In order to keep Task 1 entirely within Gormley's domain, The line of demarcation dividing the SOPAC, South Pacific, and SOWESTPAC, Southwest Pacific, areas was moved 1 degree westward to latitude 159 degrees east, skirting the western end of Guadalcanal. Gormley's instinct was to scuttle pestilence, or at least to have it postponed. In this view, he found a provisional ally in MacArthur. 1 month earlier, the imperious general had proposed to mount a direct assault on Rabaul itself, asking that two carrier task forces be transferred from the Pacific Fleet into his command. King had shot that proposal down. Now, a month later, Gormley found the general willing to join in opposition to the more indirect line of attack envisioned in Pestilence. Following a hasty conference in Melbourne, MacArthur and Gormley sent a long joint dispatch to Washington, proposing that the operation be deferred. They cited a lack of trained amphibious troops, a shortage of adequate shipping, and a dearth of sufficient land-based bomber or fighter strength. Japanese air reconnaissance flights would likely discover the incoming invasion forces, and therefore, surprise is now improbable. The fleet and supporting carrier groups would be obligated to linger in the area for 1 to 4 days, during which time they would be exposed to continued hostile air, surface, and submarine attack, posing a danger of destruction by overwhelming force. It was their joint recommendation that Pestilence be postponed pending a buildup of sea, air, and ground forces in the region. King was disappointed with Gormley and incensed with MacArthur. "I take note," he complained to Marshall, "that about 3 weeks ago, MacArthur stated that he could push right through to Rabaul. Confronted with the concrete aspects of the task, he now feels that he not only cannot undertake this extended operation, but not even the Tulagi operation." King refused to entertain any deferral of Pestilence, but he offered a fig leaf in the form of additional naval and logistical forces to support the operation, including carrier task forces built around the carriers Enterprise, Wasp, and Saratoga, and logistical vessels including tankers and troop transports. With these and other considerations in mind, the Joint Chiefs do not desire to countermand operations already underway for the execution of Task 1. General Vandegrift and his staff moved into the Hotel Cecil in downtown Wellington, a once elegant, now shabby institution that had been reserved for their exclusive use, and faced the daunting task of writing a plan. More than any other military organization in the world, the Marine Corps had studied and planned for amphibious warfare, and they were keenly aware of its risks. To land on a hostile shore was the most perilous of all major military operations. To be confident of victory, the attacker must possess overwhelming advantages, control of the surrounding sea and of the air above, and heavy bombardment of enemy positions to precede the landing, followed by rapid delivery of ground forces and heavy weaponry to the beaches. If he could achieve surprise, that would greatly mitigate the initial risks. But even if the first attack was successful, he would have to receive constant resupply by sea and reliable air protection overhead. Gormley and MacArthur doubted those conditions could be guaranteed and had placed their doubts on the record. King, half a world removed from the scene of action, had locked the operation into a seemingly impossible schedule. The grave problems confronting the Marines could easily give way to dark pessimism. Vandegrift, aware that morale was brittle, would tolerate no negative chatter. He was a native Virginian of medium height, with thinning hair and gathering jowls, a genial and gentle man, known for his steady and unflappable demeanor, even when under great stress. That trait had earned him a nickname among his Marine Corps colleagues, Sunny Jim. Once it was clear that Watchtower was inevitable, a staff officer recalled, Vandegrift refused to engage in any chit-chat concerning its merits. Those who questioned it were immediately rebuffed. Vandegrift rejected all doubts and cavils about what we were ordered to do, and regarded those who offered them with condign and unforgiving contempt. Next to nothing was known about the Solomons. Aerial photos of the area, forwarded from MacArthur's headquarters in Melbourne, were misdirected and lost in a file at Gormley's headquarters. What few maps and charts they obtained were spread out on a table, but these were too old or drafted on too large a scale to be useful. One identified Guadalcanal incorrectly as Guadalcanar. Rivers were misidentified or inaccurately located. The sea charts forwarded by the Navy were decades old and provided little detail about coral heads. The Marines put out word that they would like to interview anyone who had personal knowledge of the islands, and the New Zealanders managed to collect some of the refugees who had lived and worked in the Solomons before the Japanese invasion. Charles Whitty, a former Lever Brothers plantation director, made a crude hand-drawn sketch identifying from memory the position of ditches, swamps, hills, barbed wire fences, grass plains, coconut palms, and rivers. But Whitty, like most Europeans, had stuck mainly to the coasts and knew little of the island's interior. Even when his memory was reliable, the distances and scales were not much more than guesswork. An aerial reconnaissance mission was plainly needed, and Colonel Merrill B. Twining arranged to fly over Tsavo Sound in an Army B-17. Looking down from 3,000 feet, Twining noted and photographed an extensive network of coral reefs in the azure waters south of Tulagi. When the aircraft banked south to reconnoiter the north coast of Guadalcanal, Twining was relieved to see that the situation there was much better. Deep blue water reached almost to the shoreline, and no Japanese defensive fortifications were visible along the beach. Dogged by three floatplane Zeros, the sturdy bomber escaped by dodging into a cloudbank and returned safely to Port Moresby on New Guinea. King's stringent deadline required around-the-clock logistical preparations. The 1st Division's supplies, ammunition, and heavy equipment had been embarked haphazardly in ships that had sailed from Norfolk, New Orleans, San Francisco, and San Diego. All had to be unloaded onto the Wellington Keys, then sorted, repackaged, and reloaded for combat into smaller attack transports. The scale of the work was unprecedented. Wellington, a graceful English city enclosed by green hills, offered the best port facilities in the SOPAC command area. Aotea Key, the largest in the harbor, could accommodate 5 large vessels, and the waterfront was spacious enough to allow crates to be stacked and concealed under tarps. An early New Zealand winter brought cold rains and high winds. Cardboard boxes disintegrated under the driving rainstorms, reducing dry foodstuffs to an unsalvageable mush. Much of the division's fresh eggs, meat, and dairy products had spoiled for lack of refrigeration. Wellington's stevedores were organized into a semi-militant union and ruled by a port director who barely disguised his hostility to the Americans. The wharf workers, wharfies, were always on the verge of striking and often refused to work for reasons that seemed obscure. Turning a deaf ear to suggestions that they work at a wartime pace, they spurned any references to the danger posed by Japan. They broke for morning tea, afternoon tea, and cigarettes, and laughed at the idea of working past the customary quitting time. They walked off whenever it began to rain, sometimes explaining that they had not brought their Macintoshes. The stoppages were usually of short duration, often less than an hour, but they were maddeningly frequent. In one 24-hour period, the wharfies walked off the job 14 times. Most of the stevedoring was done by the Marines themselves, who worked around the clock, under floodlights at night, and kept at it through driving rainstorms. One Marine approvingly noted graffiti left on a Wellington wall: "All wharfies is bastards." From the start, planning for the forthcoming expedition was encumbered by an awkward and unwieldy chain of command. Admiral Gormley, to whom King had assigned principal responsibility for Watchtower, would remain shorebound at his embryonic headquarters in Noumea. Gormley gave seagoing command of the entire expeditionary force to Vice Admiral Frank Jack Fletcher, the carrier task force commander, who had come south with the carriers Enterprise and Saratoga. The third carrier, the Wasp, was en route from the United States, but required several days' repairs in Tonga Tabu. Fletcher's carrier groups, Task Force 61, would soften up the beaches with a heavy schedule of aerial bombing and strafing attacks, and provide fighter cover to intercept any incoming Japanese aircraft. The cruisers and destroyers of Task Group 62-6, commanded by Rear Admiral Victor A.C. Crutchley of the Royal Australian Navy, would bombard the beaches prior to the landings. MacArthur's air forces, operating from Port Moresby, would attack the Japanese airfield at Rabaul and the other satellite airfields in the region to suppress the inevitable enemy airstrikes on the invasion forces. Before the fleet set sail for the Solomons, it would rendezvous in the Fiji group and conduct a rehearsal landing on the island of Koro in the southern Fijis. Dog Day was set for August 7th, approximately 1 week later than the original deadline established by King. To command Operation Watchtower's amphibious forces, Task Force 62, King tapped a member of his own staff, Admiral Richmond Kelly Turner, who had headed the Navy's War Plans Division since 1940. Turner was, like King, a brilliant but touchy character. A short, balding man with steel-rimmed glasses and heavy black eyebrows, Turner was habitually irritable and quick to raise his voice. "Balls!" was a favorite exclamation. Relentlessly driven, he expected colleagues and subordinates to match his pace. He had a keen analytical mind, even his critics acknowledged that much, but he did not take kindly to criticism, even when it was offered in good faith. Rarely did Turner give fulsome praise for a job well done, and he was not slow to lay blame on others, especially when the culpability was arguably his own. He often lapsed into a hectoring, didactic style, more suited to a courtroom lawyer than an admiral. These qualities had earned him the nickname Terrible Turner. In preparing operational plans for Watchtower, Turner would have liked to begin with a blank page, but he did not reach New Zealand until mid-July, only a week before the fleet must ship out to meet King's deadline. He was therefore obliged to work backward from the draft plan prepared by Vandegrift's staff. The task force sortied from Wellington on July 22nd, a long column of transports and cargo vessels under the protection of cruisers and destroyers. A passage of 4 days through calm seas brought them to the appointed rendezvous, 367 miles south of Fiji. Each ship lay wallowing on the swell, engines throttled back. As the afternoon wore on, new masts and superstructures peaked over the horizon in every direction. Veteran sailors pointed and identified ships by name or type. Cruisers, destroyers, transports, cargo ships, minesweepers, fleet oilers, and, most encouraging to the Marines, the big box-like profiles of aircraft carriers. Grumman fighter planes patrolled the skies above. Near the carrier Enterprise was an even rarer sight. A battleship, the North Carolina. There will never be a feeling like the feeling we had when we first made out a task force coming up over the horizon with an aircraft carrier and supporting cruisers and destroyers, recalled Major Justice Chambers of the 1st Raider Battalion. For the first time since leaving the United States, the Marines realized that whatever we were going to do, we were going to have a lot of friends with us. For the good of secrecy and stealth, no one who was not directly involved in planning Watchtower had been permitted to know what was afoot. Scuttlebutt had held that the 1st Division would relieve a garrison of New Zealanders at Fiji. But here was a vast and majestic display of sea power. A fleet of 82 ships, the largest yet assembled in the Pacific War. It could only mean that a major combat operation was at hand. All over the sea, and as far out as eye could reach, the Armada modeled the water, an Enterprise pilot recalled. Everybody aboard became excited at the prospect of being part of what looked like the first big American offensive of the war. The fleet converged on the little island of Coro, where Turner had arranged for a dress rehearsal. The southern beaches of Coro were pounded by cruiser shells. Grumman F-4F fighters roared overhead in a pantomime of engaging and shooting down Japanese Zeros. Carrier dive bombers hurtled down from high altitude and planted 100-pound bombs on locations designated as enemy positions. Coro, they soon discovered, was unlike Guadalcanal in one critical respect. At low tide, shallow coral heads blocked the approach of the Higgins landing boats. The first wave of boats, filled with fully equipped Marines, ran aground and the propellers jammed. Because he did not have boats to spare, Turner canceled the landings. On the afternoon of July 27th, Admiral Fletcher summoned the task force commanders to a conference on his flagship, the carrier Saratoga. Rough seas made for difficult and even dangerous ship-to-ship transitions by boat or breeches buoy. Turner, on the destroyer Dewey, came alongside the looming shape of the big carrier. Vandegrift, accompanied by several 1st Division officers, came on the destroyer Hull. Admiral McCain, while hauling himself up a heaving ladder, was drenched by a flood of spoiled milk and garbage spewing from a waste chute. The brass convened in Fletcher's wardroom. Notably, Gormley did not attend the conference. The COMSOPAC was represented by his chief of staff, Rear Admiral Daniel J. Callahan. According to several participants, Admiral Fletcher was in a foul temper and opened the meeting with a distinctly unconstructive tone. He cleared the room of all officers below the rank of admiral or general. Vandegrift judged Fletcher to be nervous and tired and ill-informed about the details of Watchtower. The admiral seemed to think the entire operation was a misadventure and quickly let us know he did not think it would succeed. All could agree that the operation had been rushed and lamented the lack of time for careful and thorough preparation. There were not even sufficient copies of Fletcher's and Turner's operational orders and annexes, and many fleet staff officers and ship captains would have to work from notes. Discussion ranged over details of logistics, refueling, schedules of airstrikes on Tulagi and Guadalcanal, the occupation of the Santa Cruz Island Group, and the planned relief of the Marines by Army garrison troops. The discussions took an ugly turn when the subject changed to the controversial issue of air protection for the landing operations. Turner estimated that 4 or 5 days were needed to unload equipment, ammunition, and supplies onto the beachheads. Fletcher tersely replied that he intended to keep his aircraft carriers in the vicinity for only 2. A tense debate brought from Fletcher a begrudging concession. The carriers would stay for 3 days. Beyond dog day plus 2, Turner's amphibious force would have to manage without air cover. With that, Fletcher dismissed the conference, and the commanders parted on edgy terms. As the Marines descended into the boat that would carry them back to their ship, a staff officer found Vandegrift deeply disturbed and in no mood to talk. The passage to the Solomons was pleasingly uneventful. The combined task forces, zigzagging to thwart enemy submarines, shaped a westerly course north of New Caledonia and into the Coral Sea, leaving Guadalcanal well to starboard. The seas were calm, the breezes mild, and a low cloud ceiling sheltered the fleet from Japanese reconnaissance planes. "It didn't seem like war at all to me at first," said Roland Smoot, captain of the destroyer Monson. "We cruised those beautiful southern waters just as casually and unconcerned as though we were going to a Sunday school picnic. On the transports, Marines cleaned and oiled their rifles, machine guns, and cartridges. They belted ammunition, sighted along their rifles, sharpened their bayonets and knives. They scattered their gear over the decks, took inventory, and repacked. They secured their packs, with bedrolls folded carefully on top, and stood them in rows along the bulkheads. Their personal belongings went into sea bags to be entrusted to the crews of the ships. Each man was to carry 6 cans of sea rations, enough to feed him for 2 days. 100 rounds of ammunition in a cartridge belt, 100 more in a bandolier. 2 grenades. A pickaxe or shovel, one or the other as he chose. 2 canteens, a gas mask, a first aid kit, a bedroll, a poncho, a mosquito net, a mess kit. To pass the time, they sang, smoked, played cards, or wrote home. At night, they slept in hot, dirty holds, in bunks 4 or 5 tiers high. To escape the heat, some of the men curled up on deck or bedded down in a lifeboat. On August 5th, with the 3 carrier groups leading the column, the fleet turned northward for the final leg of its approach. That afternoon, the weather cleared and the sun beat down for several hours. But their luck held. No Japanese snoopers appeared overhead, and in the mid-afternoon, they entered another frontal area and were blanketed by dense overcast and intermittent rain squalls. On the following afternoon, dog day minus one, Fletcher's 3 carrier groups turned away to take up their position south of the weather coast of Guadalcanal. Turner's amphibious force continued north toward Cheetah Shoals, off the mountainous island's westernmost point. At 11.05 p.m., the northbound fleet divided into 2 double columns, separated by 1,000 yards. The first, Transport Group X-Ray, turned east to hug the north coast of Guadalcanal. The second, Transport Group Yoke, proceeded north of the stratovolcanic cone of Savo Island and then turned east toward Tulagi and the Ingela Group. The night was dark, the sea calm. Not even a lit cigarette was permitted on deck. A crescent moon rose above the horizon in the east. Lieutenant Herbert L. Merrillat recalled, "Tension in the air, and complete silence save for the steady throbbing of engines, the gentle splash of ships' prows cutting through the water, and the hushed movements of men on the open decks." The cruisers and destroyers surged ahead at 27 knots, fast enough to throw salt spray over the rails. At that speed, the warships would show bone in teeth, a long white bow wave that could be seen even on dark nights. Would Japanese lookouts detect them and raise the alarm? No shore guns opened fire. Nothing stirred along the shore. "It was a most prosaic type of thing," said Captain Smoot. "We had achieved complete surprise." From the rails of the transports, the Marines studied the looming shape of Guadalcanal. It was a high, black, jagged mass, with contours barely distinguishable against the backdrop of a slightly lighter sky. They could see little in the pre-dawn darkness, but their nostrils took in the rich, fetid odor of damp vegetation. With the first flush of dawn, they gradually discerned the rugged, bluish-green mountains, the heavily forested ridgelines, the light patches of open plain, and the serpentine columns of trees and foliage that followed the rivers down to the coast. Binoculars swept over the native villages just beyond the beaches, little clusters of fiber roofs and garden plots. Every few miles along the shore, a river delta protruded to form a point. One of these marked the mouth of the Lunga River, just west of Beach Red, where the Marines would put ashore. A few miles inland was their main objective, the nearly completed airfield. The Marines had been warned to expect a bloody fight on Beach Red. Those who survived the initial assault would have to fight their way inland, storming across drainage ditches that might double as trenches, fording rivers under fire, and advancing through fields of razor-sharp kunai grass. At every stage, they would encounter thousands of well-armed and fanatical Japanese. A Marine lieutenant told the journalist Richard Tregaskis that he expected 1 in 4 men to die in the first wave. Even so, spirits were high. Private William Rogal felt a knot in my stomach, but it was no greater or more intense than the knot associated with stage fright. More than death or injury, Rogal feared disgrace, or showing the white feather. William Manchester, the Marine private who would earn literary fame as a memoirist and biographer, wrote that, "Vitality surged through you like a powerful drug, even though the idea of death held no attraction to you." More than anything, he just wanted off the filthy, crowded transport that had been his universe for more than a month. A reserve captain who had been a grocery wholesaler in Boston said he felt no more nervous than if I were being sent out to do a tough job in civilian life. You know, like trying to sell a big order when there's a lot of sales resistance. At 6:13 a.m., as veins of gray light spread from east to west through the overcast, the heavy cruiser Quincy trained her main battery on Lunga Point and opened fire. The blast force of her 8-inch guns punched craters into the sea alongside the ship. Heavy concussions reverberated across Tsavo Sound and echoed back from the hills on the surrounding islands. To Colonel Twining, it was an unforgettable moment of history. The first Allied counter-invasion of the war. The first step on the long, bloody road to Tokyo. 4 cruisers and 6 destroyers joined the Quincy, their greenish-yellow muzzle flashes lighting up the sea and the ships and the hills and ridgelines of the surrounding islands. Red tracer lines arced toward the shore, and powerful explosions backlit the palms along the beach. 1 shell found a fuel dump in the village of Kukum, just west of Lunga Point. The result was a tremendous detonation, a sheet of flame 100 feet high, and a tower of oily black smoke. Lookouts on the light cruiser San Juan in the Northern Fire Support Group opened fire on Tulagi, Gavutu, and Tanambogo at a range of 2,000 yards. Within 2 minutes, the waterfronts were reduced to smoking wreckage. 5 minutes after the first salvo, the ship's guns fell abruptly silent. That was the cue for the Grumman F-4F Wildcat fighters, launched from the carriers before dawn, to begin their initial strafing runs over the unfinished airstrip. Red tracer lines reached down from the 50-caliber guns and ricocheted back into the sky, forming a shallow luminescent V pattern. 16 Grummans of the Wasps Fighting Squadron 71, VF-71, flew low over the bay south of Ingela and riddled the seaplanes moored off Tulagi and Tanambogo with 50-caliber incendiary fire. Several of the enemy's Kawanishi flying boats and float plane fighters were transformed into floating infernos. Turning back for a second strafing run, VF-71 laid waste to landing craft, fuel barges, and machine gun emplacements. SBD Dauntless dive bombers planted 1,000-pound bombs on assigned targets along the Guadalcanal shoreline. As the bombers pulled out of their dives and turned west to return to the carriers, the cruisers and destroyers opened up again. From the Macaulay, General Vandegrift and Admiral Turner inspected the scene through binoculars. The landing beaches were marked by colored smoke pots that had been dropped by cruiser floatplanes. On Guadalcanal, plumes of smoke were uncoiling along a 3-mile length of shoreline between the Lunga and Tinaru rivers. The naval guns and carrier planes had done their work. Japanese buildings, barracks, radio stations, wharves, camps, warehouses, and anti-aircraft batteries were burning brightly. There were no muzzle flashes ashore, or any enemy troops to be seen. Cruiser planes scouting the island from overhead reported no enemy activity. Even the natives seemed to have fled into the bush. Vandegrift and his staff officers noted the imposing mass of Mount Austin a few miles behind Lunga Point. Their maps had identified it as a grassy knoll of uncertain elevation, but it evidently stood more than 1,000 feet above the surrounding plains. They would have to pull in their lines and exclude it from their perimeter. H hour, the landing on Tulagi, had been set for 0800. 0 hour, the landing on Guadalcanal, was to be half an hour later. At 0630, Turner passed the word to begin lowering boats. Each craft was lowered away to the harsh clank of chains running through davits. The coxswains circled cautiously, engines muffled at low RPM, exhaust clouds wafting across the sea, and awaited the signal flag that would summon them to return and embark troops. A few minutes before 7, the Marines began going down the cargo nets. They took care to grasp the vertical lines, not the horizontal ones, where fingers might be crushed under another man's boot. Heavy gear was rigged with quick release straps, a precaution against drowning should they fall into the sea. Each Marine stepped into the flat bottom of a Higgins boat and took a seat. When a boat was full, the coxswain pulled away and began to circle. Conditions were near perfect. The sea was as calm as glass. Cargo nets were lowered on both sides of the transports, allowing for simultaneous port and starboard disembarkation. There were no overturned boats, no casualties, and no delays. After the comedy of errors at Coro, the smooth execution of the landing operations came as a welcome surprise. Major Donald Dixon called it one of the slickest things I have ever seen. At 7:41 a.m., the first wave of boats passed the line of departure, formed between two destroyers, and opened their throttles. The Marines crouched down, heads below the gunwales. Spray flew over the sides and into their faces. The small American flag at the stern of each craft snapped briskly in the wind. A sailor watching from the Vincennes thought that it looked like a Newport boat race with our flags flying from the sterns headed into the beach. It was thrilling to watch such an undertaking, and still there wasn't any artillery fire or anything of that sort, and we were beginning to get a little apprehensive because we knew it was bound to come sooner or later. The destroyers continued raking the shore with their 5-inch guns, then fell silent as the first boats scraped onto the sand. The Marines clambered over the sides and trudged through the surf. They met no resistance at all. From Kukum to the mouth of the Tinaru, the beaches and adjacent coconut groves were apparently deserted. A white star shell shot up into the sky, signaling an unopposed landing. When the third and fourth waves arrived later that morning, the beachhead was weirdly serene. An occasional rifle shot was heard in the distance, but no concentrated and sustained bursts that would suggest a firefight. On the incoming boats, Marines lined up in leisurely fashion. One by one, they leapt from the bow, over the surf, to avoid soaking their boots. Men were relaxing in the shade, smoking cigarettes, or trying to open coconuts with their knives or bayonets. A few had even stripped down to their underwear and plunged into the surf for a swim. Native huts with thatched roofs were being commandeered as shore party command posts, and signs nailed to palm trees indicated where cargo handlers should stack and sort incoming equipment and provisions. A medical tent had been set up under a Red Cross banner, but at 10:30 a.m., the only casualty was a young man who had cut his hand while trying to open a coconut with a machete. It all seemed too easy, even a bit ominous. Did the Japanese hope to draw them into an ambush? Chapter 2. Awakened by the naval barrage, the Japanese on Tulagi had been caught completely by surprise. Captain Shigetoshi Miyazaki, commander of the seaplane base, fired an initial radio warning to Rabaul. As the first landing boat scraped ashore on what the Marines had designated Beach Blue, he and his small force of Special Naval Landing Force troops withdrew into the island's hilly interior, but not before sending a final spirited broadcast. "We will defend to the last man. Pray for our success." Rabaul, 650 miles to the northwest, was headquarters of the 8th Fleet, commanded by the newly arrived Vice Admiral Gunichi Mikawa, and of the 25th Air Flotilla, a land-based aviation command with about 90 operational aircraft, including bombers, reconnaissance planes, and Zero fighters. With two working airfields and two more in reserve, Rabaul was the axis of Japanese air power in the region, the backstop to smaller satellite airfields at Kavieng, Lei, Salamawa, Buin, and Buka. It offered a superb natural harbor, a flooded caldera more than a mile in diameter. But the Japanese conquerors had little affection for the place. It was a hot, dusty, primitive township, disturbed by frequent earthquakes and choked with pumice and gray-black ash from the volcano Tavorvor, whose imposing black cone dominated the view to the south. Admiral Mikawa's headquarters was in a cramped, dilapidated colonial building. Enlisted men were quartered in crude barracks and fed mostly barley rice and miso soup, with open-pit cesspools for toilets. The best thing about Rabaul, according to an officer stationed there, was a bathhouse erected by the Japanese over the hot springs at the base of Tavorvor. Nothing boosted Japanese spirits like a hot bath. Upon receiving word of the American invasion in the Solomons, Rear Admiral Sadayoshi Yamada prepared to strike the American fleet. 27 twin-engine G-4M bombers and 9 Zero fighters had been fueled and armed for a scheduled attack on Rabi, an Allied airfield in New Guinea. Yamada now ordered that the flights be diverted to the Tulagi-Guadalcanal area and launched immediately. He would not even allow the bombers to be rearmed with aerial torpedoes, which were far more effective against ships than land bombs, for fear that his planes might be caught on the ground and destroyed. When the Zero pilots examined their charts, they whistled in disbelief. 650 miles down, and then all the way back, their single-seat fighter had never flown a combat mission of that range. The flight leader told his men that conserving fuel must be their overriding concern. They would fly with belly tanks, which would diminish the Zero's performance in air combat, and they could afford only a brief visit to the enemy fleet. Under these conditions, they would fight at a severe disadvantage. Shortly before 10 o'clock a.m., Guadalcanal time, the big G-4Ms began roaring down the runways, followed a few minutes later by the Zeros. The 45 planes coalesced into an arrowhead configuration, with the bombers locked in three step-down V of V formations, and the Zeros trailing closely on either flank. The long flight took them directly over the large island of Bougainville, which was home to two intrepid coast watchers who had pulled well back into the bush. W.J. Jack Reed was concealed at an advanced observation post in the northern jungle hills. Paul Mason was ensconced in a remote hideaway called Malabita Hill, near the south end of the island. In preparation for watchtower and to avoid coding delays, both men had been instructed to report hostile aircraft sightings immediately by voice transmissions in plain language. Shortly before 11 o'clock a.m., Mason heard the drone of aircraft overhead. Looking up through the canopy of foliage, he saw an armada of Japanese bombers. He counted 24. Immediately, he transmitted, "From Stowe, 24 bombers headed yours." The report was copied in Port Moresby, relayed to Townsville, sent immediately to Pearl Harbor, and then broadcast to the Watchtower task forces. In spite of its circuitous route, Mason's message arrived on the Saratoga and the Macaulay when it was just 30 minutes old. Flight time from South Bougainville to Guadalcanal was more than 2 hours, so Fletcher and Turner had plenty of time to react. Turner got his ships dispersed and underway for emergency evasive action, and the carriers launched fighters to intercept the incoming planes. Even with ample warning, Fletcher faced daunting logistical problems. His Grummans had to protect two task forces separated by 60 to 75 miles, requiring about 30 minutes of flight time. Dogfights would burn fuel and oblige their early return to the flat tops, and once the fighters returned, there was the problem of clearing the flight deck so that they could land and be refueled. The day's crowded flight operation schedule placed heavy demands on all three flight decks. It was essentially the same problem that had lost the Battle of Midway for the Japanese. At 1:15 p.m., as the Japanese strike closed on Tsavo Sound, just 8 Wildcats were in position to defend the amphibious fleet. They were at 12,000 feet, below an opaque layer of overcast. The Japanese G-4Ms approached at 16,000 feet, above the cloud ceiling, thus invisible to the Wildcats. The fighter control circuits rang with radar warnings. All at once, the bombers broke through the clouds in a shallow dive. Lieutenant James J. Sutherland, leader of a division of Saratoga F-4Fs, radioed a tally-ho. Horizontal bombers, 3 divisions, 9 planes each, over Tsavo, headed for transports. Let's go get them, boys. Sutherland dropped to his left and opened a few bursts on the nearest Japanese aircraft, at a range of just 500 yards. He pressed this promising attack and sent one G-4M down in flames, but seconds later, the Zeros descended through the clouds and found 3 of his wingmen in their sights. 2 Wildcats went spinning into the sea, and the others were forced to dive for their lives. Taking in the view from below the overcast, the Japanese airmen were astonished by the size of the American fleet. The bombers continued east, descending to 10,000 feet, and opened their payloads over the X-ray transports, maneuvering at high speed off Lunga Point. The sky was mottled with the dark smudges of anti-aircraft bursts, but the Japanese planes stayed in formation. As the sticks of bombs fell behind them in a glinting diagonal tail, the American helmsmen coolly steered to avoid them. Every bomb fell harmlessly into the sea near Lunga Point. The G-4Ms banked west for the long run back to Rabaul. A furious fighter melee continued over Tsavo Island and western Guadalcanal. Among the Zero pilots were 2 of the most lethal fighter aces in the Imperial Japanese Navy. Hiroyoshi Nishizawa, who would eventually be credited with 87 kills, making him Japan's top-ranked ace, and Saburo Sakai, who would survive the war with about 60 claimed kills. Sakai authored a fascinating and credible post-war memoir, Samurai, which was translated into English in the 1950s. Sutherland, after flaming one of the G-4Ms, went into a spiraling dive to avoid 2 pursuing Zeros. Lieutenant Joseph R. Daly's aircraft, riddled with 7.7mm machine gun fire, began to turn over and descend toward the sea. His fuel tank ignited, and the flames spread into his cockpit. My clothes were on fire, my pants and shirt burning. I could see nothing but red fire all around me. Daly wrenched open the canopy and leapt out. He dropped through the cloud cover at 7,000 feet and pulled his chute. Saburo Sakai had never seen an F-4F until this moment. Looking down, about 1,500 feet below, he saw a lone Wildcat in a skirmish with 3 Zeros. Lieutenant Sutherland was flying a series of tight left spirals that denied his pursuers a clean shot at him. He repeatedly forced the Zeros to overtake him and peppered their wingtips with 50 caliber fire. Sakai dived into the fight and was immediately taken aback by Sutherland's skill. Never had I seen an enemy plane move so quickly or so gracefully before. In a dance of snap rolls and sudden throttle chops, Sakai and Sutherland maneuvered for advantage, until both aircraft slipped into a vertical spiral, with one wing pointed down at the sea and the other up at the sky. Intense G-forces shoved both men into their seats and forced them to strain their necks to keep their heads erect. After the fifth spiral, Sutherland broke out into a loop, and Sakai locked onto his tail. "I had him," Sakai wrote. The Zero could outfly any fighter in the world in this kind of maneuver. Sakai fired a long burst of 7.7mm caliber rounds into Sutherland's cockpit, but the sturdy Grumman flew on, apparently unperturbed. The Japanese pilot then fed fuel to his engine and flew alongside the Wildcat. The two men made eye contact. Sakai saw that Sutherland was badly wounded, with blood on his shoulder and chest. Sutherland lifted his hand and waved. Sakai shook his fist and shouted for the American to fight on, instead of flying along like a clay pigeon. But Sutherland's guns had jammed. His aircraft had been hit hundreds of times, and the aluminum skin of the fuselage and wings was shredded so badly that the frame was bared to Sakai's view. His instrument panel was completely destroyed, his canopy was shattered, his radio was dead, his flaps were not responding, and oil was coursing into the cockpit. He had 11 separate wounds. He had no choice but to bail out. As Sakai fired several 20mm cannon rounds into the Wildcat's wing root, setting the plane afire, Sutherland unbuckled and got free of the cockpit. He had just enough altitude to pull his chute before hitting the treetops. Though suffering severe wounds, including a 7.7mm round that passed through his foot, Sutherland managed to make his way overland to the American lines. Sakai then chased a formation of 8 American dive bombers, elements of VB-6 and VS-5 of the Enterprise. The SBDs held formation, and the rear gunners concentrated their fire into the engine and cockpit of the oncoming Zero. A 30-caliber round grazed Sakai's skull and blinded his right eye. Somehow he managed not only to survive this grievous wound, but to fly 650 miles back to Rabaul and land safely. Sakai would lose the eye, but return to flight service in 1944. A flight of 9 Type Aichi D3A2, Allied codename VAL, dive bombers, armed with 60-kilogram bombs, dived on the X-ray transports off Lunga Point. One bomb hit the superstructure of the destroyer Mugford, killing 21 men, but doing little damage to the ship. Wildcats chased the retreating dive bombers and peppered them with 50-caliber fire. All the VALs were destroyed, either in air combat or by ditching at sea. 12 of 18 crewmen were also lost. Off the weather coast of Guadalcanal, the mood in Task Force TF-61 was decidedly upbeat. A destroyer officer watched the first wave of planes as they returned to the Wasp. Jubilant pilots circled us, rocking their wings and waving as they passed overhead. As the planes recovered, the word spread quickly. The initial bombing and strafing attacks had put every Japanese plane in the area out of action before they could get into the air. But the carrier's air operations were only beginning. Between first light and dusk, the 3 flat tops completed an extraordinary 704 plane launches and 686 recoveries. Beginning long before dawn, with a bleary-eyed breakfast, followed by the call to general quarters at 0500, the crews had worked to the brink of exhaustion. Flights had been planned in painstaking detail and down to the minute. Admiral Thomas C. Kincaid, commander of Task Force 16, compared the day's operations to a railroad schedule. Planes were landed, refueled, rearmed, replenished with oxygen, respotted, and sent back up at a record-breaking pace. In one case, the Wasp turned around an 8-plane squadron in 16 minutes. Inevitably, there were mishaps. Planes spun into the sea or catapulted over the crash barrier and had to be jettisoned over the side. Some failed to find their carriers on the return and were forced to ditch at sea. The air groups had successfully protected Turner's fleet, but the day's fighter losses were worryingly high. 15 Grummans had been destroyed or forced to ditch, and 5 more had been badly damaged. In the initial melee with the Zeros, which were piloted by some of the top aces in the Japanese Navy, the Wildcats had suffered 50% losses. The superior speed and maneuverability of the Zero remained a grave concern. Grummans were needed over the carriers to provide air protection. They were needed to protect Turner's fleet in Tsavo Sound. They would be needed to escort any outbound airstrike, should Japanese carriers appear on the scene. 18 fighter planes per carrier were nowhere near enough, Admiral Kincaid concluded, and the fighter complement would be doubled by the end of 1942. For now, however, Fletcher had to do the best with what he had, and he had good reason to wonder whether he had enough fighters to cover the fleet on D-Day plus one. Shortly before 3 that afternoon, General Vandegrift went ashore. A Higgins boat filled with senior officers of the 1st Division churned in toward Beach Red, picking its way through dozens of boats plying the waters between the anchored transports and cargo ships. As he set foot on Guadalcanal, the general noted that cargo was beginning to pile up on the beach. There were too few men available to handle it properly. The problem would have to wait, however. His first concern was the state of his defensive perimeter. Units were advancing inland and along the shore, but the enemy was nowhere to be seen. "I'm beginning to doubt whether there's a Jap on the whole damned island," he remarked. To the west, forward elements of the 1st Battalion, 5th Marines, had halted on the bank of the Elu River. Vandegrift, coming up from the rear in a jeep, found them moving as if it were about to encounter the entire Imperial Army. He ordered them across. Engineers were summoned to improvise a makeshift bridge. They laid spare lumber over the riverbed with the help of an amphibious tractor. It was not much to look at, but it bore the weight of jeeps and artillery. Beyond the Elu, the natural terrain barriers of Guadalcanal began to work against them. Troops wielded machetes to hack a 4-foot-wide path, wide enough for ammunition carts to follow, but soon became bogged down in a huge mangrove swamp. To the east, advance parties pushed along the coconut-strewn beach, through abandoned native villages, to the Tanaru River. They hesitated to cross. The absence of enemy resistance seemed bizarre and even ominous. Major Dixon thought the men expected to bump into the Japs any minute and were wondering why they didn't. They said, "These damn Japs are setting a trap for us, and we are going to walk into this trap one of these minutes." That wasn't a very pleasant feeling. A wealth of first-rate assets had been left behind by the enemy. 2 powerhouses, supplied with new electrical generators and ample fuel. A radio receiver station stocked with equipment and spares. 50,000 to 60,000 gallons of gasoline and diesel fuel. A fleet of trucks. 2 working water pumps. 9 road rollers. And several tons of cement. Weapons of various categories and calibers fell into the Americans' hands, including 2 working anti-aircraft batteries. A hospital tent, stocked with excellent medical supply kits and water purification tablets, was commandeered by Navy corpsmen. In a laborer's camp across the Elu River, Sergeant James Hurlbut found a hot iron left on a pair of officers' trousers. It had burned all the way through to the ironing board. Half-eaten meals had been left on dining tables, with chopsticks left propped on the edges of the dishes, or dropped in haste on the floor mat. All around the camps was evidence of the terrific cannonading delivered earlier that morning. Coconut palms torn to pieces, and tents shredded by high explosive fragments. Major Dixon's unit was the first to reach the Japanese headquarters building near the airfield. Among the officers' possessions, they found a souvenir hunter's bonanza, swords, medals, capes, and starched white uniforms. In an adjoining quartermaster's supply building was a large supply of rice, dried fish, canned crab, beer, sake, candy, and cigarettes. A guard was posted to prevent looting. The main Japanese wharf at Kukum was placed under the direction of a Coast Guard detachment and rear echelon units, engineers, motor transport operators, radio men, began claiming the huts and tents left by the Japanese. By nightfall on August 7th, the little village was beginning to look like a conventional ship-to-shore depot. On Tulagi, across Savo Sound, the Marines had likewise gone ashore unopposed. The naval barrage had been superb. The cruiser San Juan had put some 800 rounds of 5-inch shells into the high ground above Beach Blue prior to the landing, and then lifted the onslaught precisely 3 minutes before the first boats touched the beach. Beach Blue had been left completely undefended by the Japanese, who apparently had concluded that the shallow coral heads offshore would discourage any landing attempt there. The raiders crossed the narrow waist of the island without much difficulty, taking the little settlement known as Sasapi Village, but when they turned east, resistance stiffened. Japanese snipers had concealed themselves in trees and the underbrush. The rattle of machine gun fire was heard offshore and even on Guadalcanal, 20 miles away, where Colonel Twining recalled, "We felt left out." The remaining enemy troops, bottled up in the southeast corner of the island, went to ground in dugouts and caves. Demolition teams were brought up to destroy those positions, but many were connected by subterranean tunnels. The fight for Tulagi was savage and bloody. As Major Justice Chambers recalled, "When you would blast them out of one dugout, you would find that there was nobody in there, and you would find a hole through which they had crawled to another place." That night, Japanese soldiers were sniping, shouting at us, throwing grenades at us, whistling, and carrying out all the tricks of the trade we had read about in the pamphlets, but I suspect none of us ever believed. East of Tulagi lay the minuscule islands of Gavutu and Tanambogo, connected to one another by a wooden causeway. Some 500 Japanese naval infantrymen, sometimes called Japanese Marines, were on these islands, dug into trench lines and artillery emplacements, and they had put up an even more desperate fight than their comrades on Tulagi. A pre-landing naval bombardment leveled most of the trees and buildings, but the defenders emerged as soon as the Marines went ashore on Gavutu's northeast coast and pinned the invaders down in a mangrove swamp. The Marines put two tanks ashore on Tanambogo, but one was destroyed almost immediately. George Kittredge, a gunnery officer on the Chicago, watched through his turret's periscope as a platoon of Japanese troops swarmed over the tank, poured gasoline over it, and set it afire. The hatch opened and a Marine emerged. He was knocked down immediately and beaten to death with rifle butts. A Japanese soldier dropped a grenade into the tank, killing the remaining occupant. Kittredge's 8-inch gun fired, and in the next moment, the entire scene had vanished. No tank, no enemy soldiers. Just a pall of white smoke and a very large hole in the ground. 70 Marines would give their lives in the conquest of these islands, which were not secured until midday on August 8th. Guadalcanal remained largely peaceful that first night. Scattered gunfire along the perimeter kept the Marines on edge, but no counterattack developed. At dawn on the 8th, increasingly confident that the Japanese did not intend to make a stand at all. They advanced in force onto the Lunga Plain and took possession of the unfinished airstrip. They encountered no one but a few unarmed Korean workers, who broke and ran at the first sight of the Marines. Those who surrendered told the same story. The Japanese troops had fled to the west. The airfield was nearly finished. Only a few hundred feet in the middle section remained to be filled in and graded. Another week of work would bring it to completion. At sunrise, Task Force 61 cruised south of Guadalcanal at 8 knots. It looked to be another day of light easterly winds, requiring the task force to run at high speed to create sufficient wind over the decks for flight operations. The WASP air group would fly search patterns to the north and west, while the Saratoga's planes remained deck-bound in case an enemy carrier group should appear in striking range. After the previous day's losses, Fletcher would be operating with an acute shortage of fighters. Fuel limitations would require their frequent return to the carriers. The air protection scheme was beginning to fray, and there was every reason to expect another round of air attacks from Rabaul. From his hideout in the jungle hills of northern Bougainville Island, Coast Watcher Jack Reed watched over the Buka Passage, a narrow and strategically vital seaway between Bougainville and Buka Island. A dark, sinewy, thickly bearded lieutenant of the Australian Royal Navy, Reed had served for more than a decade in South Pacific postings as a patrol officer. His observation post lay directly in the flight path between Rabaul and Guadalcanal, and that alone made him a critical node in the coast-watching network. Constant movement was a precaution against being caught by the Japanese, who were hunting him diligently. On August 8th, Reed was preparing to move to a new post at a remote native village called Porapora. After a regularly scheduled radio check-in with Station Vig, Port Moresby, he dialed in to a 7 megacycles frequency in hopes of picking up stray aviation communications. Immediately, his ears were filled with radio chatter of the American carrier pilots. It did not take Reed long to put the pieces together. The Americans had descended in force on the southeastern Solomons. As he was pondering the significance of this development, one of his native scouts heard the drone of aircraft engines overhead. Through a break in the jungle canopy, a large formation of torpedo-armed G-4Ms came into direct view, only a few hundred feet above their heads. Reed counted 24. He immediately got back on the teleradio, raised Vig, and blurted out in plain English, "Bombers now going southeast." For the second consecutive day, a coast watcher had provided vital forewarning of an incoming airstrike. It was a pattern that would continue throughout the Solomons campaign. Every day, or nearly so, the Japanese sent airstrikes down from Rabaul. And every day, Jack Reed or Paul Mason spotted the southbound formations overhead and relayed the warning. Reed was especially well situated for this purpose, because his vantage point at Porapora commanded a panoramic view of all of Buka Island to the north, the eastern sea channels leading down the slot, the body of water between the double file of islands that form the Solomon's Archipelago, and the skies through which Japanese aircraft must pass. The whole lay before you as a huge mosaic of detail and tropical splendor, he wrote in a 1943 report to the Australian Navy. Moreover, Reed's lookout camp at Porapora was difficult to approach overland, and he had won the stalwart loyalty of the native tribesmen, who gave him advance warning of any Japanese search parties. He was never caught. Reed's transmission was picked up at Pearl Harbor and relayed to the American commanders, who received it 25 minutes after it was broadcast. That provided ample time for Turner's transports and screening ships to get underway for evasive action, and for the carrier planes to gain altitude so as to be in proper attacking position when the enemy arrived. The twin-engine bombers, painted green with the rising sun disc on their fuselages, made a shrewd approach. The low-flying formation approached from the north, over Indispensable Strait, concealing themselves in the radar shadow of the Anguilla Island group, then turned back over Sea Lark Channel to attack from the east. The American fighters were at 27,000 feet above Savo Island, far out of position to repel the attack. At precisely noon, the intruders were spotted by gunners on the cruiser Australia. They were roaring in over the reefs, just 20 to 30 feet above the sea. Richard Tregaskis, watching from Guadalcanal, saw flat, sinister shapes prowling low over the water, darting among the transports. The fleet was wheeling and circling in anticipation of the attack. As the enemy planes came into close range, the heavy repeating concussions of the big anti-aircraft guns were joined by the higher rattle of the shorter-range weapons. All but five of the Japanese planes blew up, broke into pieces, cartwheeled, or dived into the sea. Only three managed to launch a torpedo, and only one of those struck home. The destroyer Jarvis was hit near the bow. She limped away and was later sunk by a second air attack, resulting in the loss of her entire crew. American Grummans, diving from high altitude, chased the survivors as they withdrew to the west. A stricken G4M crashed into the upper deck of one of the transports, the George F. Elliott. The ship's Marines had disembarked, so casualties were limited, but she burned fiercely from stem to stern and trailed a plume of thick black smoke into the sky. 2 hours later, as the remnants of the flight passed over northern Bougainville, Jack Reed counted only 8 survivors. Vast quantities of munitions, equipment, and supplies remained to be brought ashore. 1,000 drums of aviation gasoline for Gavutu, 1,500 drums for Guadalcanal, small arms and machine gun ammunition, aviation lubricating oil, engine spares, radio equipment, water distillation equipment, and water cans. Semaphore flags, Aldis lamps, smoke signaling devices, binoculars, typewriters, pencils, message blanks. 60 days rations for all troops. Crates and drums had been landed haphazardly on Beach Red, and the shoreline was so congested with unsorted supplies that General Vandegrift had to ask Turner to suspend landing operations. With no advanced port facilities available, everything had to be transferred into small craft, manhandled up to the beach, and sorted into supply dumps. 2 days of air attacks had left barely a scratch on the fleet, but the recurring threats had required Turner's ships to maneuver evasively for hours on end, during which time nothing could be unloaded. The danger of beach congestion had been anticipated, but in the rush to plan and execute Watchtower, the commanders had never faced it squarely. The landing craft were poor substitutes for proper cargo lighters. Navy beachmasters had neither the training nor the experience to do the job properly, but even if they had, there were not enough laborers. Turner's operation plan specified that shore party commanders will call upon troop commanders in their immediate vicinity for assistance in handling supplies from landing beaches to dumps. Prisoners and stragglers will be used to assist in this task. But no Marine unit had been detailed to the task in advance, and the Navy boat crews were not numerous enough to do the work. More hands were needed on the beaches. The chaos prompted mutual recriminations. Citing doctrine and precedent, the Marines insisted that the commander of troops ashore should be authorized to put a stop to unloading if the beachhead was not yet prepared to receive supplies. Turner blamed the Marines for bringing a vast amount of unnecessary impediments and for failing to provide labor for the unloading. "The Marines have got to do this," he wrote a colonel commanding the 7th Marines. "Ship's crews can't run boats and winches, operate the ship, man guns, furnish personnel to handle boat traffic, repairs, and evacuation at the beach, and at the same time furnish unloading details. Navy landing boat crews offered some barbed comments to a number of Marines on Beach Red, who were neither fighting nor working. Vandegrift was unwilling to pull combat troops back off the perimeter, but Turner, who planned to land forces on Indaney in the Santa Cruz Islands, refused his request for a replacement battalion to provide beach labor. Not until the morning of August 9th was the problem addressed with the simple expedient of dropping supplies farther down the beach. Ammunition, crates, shells, and other materials were simply stacked among the palm trees, left for the Marines to sort out in good time. Admiral Mikawa, newly appointed commander of the 8th Fleet, had arrived in Rabaul little more than a week before the invasion of Guadalcanal. Japanese command arrangements in the theater were fragmented and illogical. The Navy's 8th Base Force had a responsibility for garrison defense of New Britain and adjoining territories, while the 25th Air Flotilla controlled all air operations. But a cold rivalry divided them and rendered any effective cooperation unlikely. The 17th Army Staff, also headquartered at Rabaul, was heavily engaged in operations against Port Moresby on New Guinea. No one seemed to welcome the arrival of Mikawa's 8th Fleet, as all of the suitable administrative buildings and barracks in Rabaul had already been occupied. Mikawa decided to station most of his cruisers at the rear base of Kavieng on New Ireland, where they would be less vulnerable to Allied air attack. Mikawa, a cerebral and soft-spoken officer, had served as Chuichi Nagumo's second-in-command through the first 6 months of the war. He had commanded the battleships and cruisers of Kido Butai, the carrier striking force, and had witnessed firsthand the disaster at Midway, which would weigh heavily on his mind in the action to come. On July 30th, he broke out his flag above a tumble-down house in Rabaul Township. Lacking even a toilet, it was far beneath his station, but he had bigger problems. On August 7th, immediately after receiving word of the American invasion in the Lower Solomons, Mikawa mustered his surface naval forces for a counterstrike. The 17th Army was unwilling to provide reinforcements for Guadalcanal. The Army staff took the view that the Americans could be ejected with ease and in good time. So Mikawa pulled together a pitifully small force of 315 riflemen and Japanese Marines to be embarked on a transport. It was subsequently torpedoed by U.S. submarine S-38 off Cape St. George, New Ireland. The Chokai put into Rabaul to embark the admiral and his staff, and then put to sea at 2:30 p.m., in company with the light cruisers Tenryu and Yubari, and the destroyer Yunagi. They rendezvoused with Cruiser Division 6, Aoba, Kinugasa, Kako, and Furutaka, off Cape St. George shortly before nightfall. Mikawa intended a surprise nighttime raid into Tsavo Sound to destroy Turner's vulnerable transports and cargo ships. Though the 8 vessels in his column had not previously operated together, each ship and its crew were superbly outfitted, armed, and trained for night surface combat. Since the early 1920s, Japanese naval planners had envisioned a scenario for war with the United States that would require Zengen Sakusen, attrition operations. Assuming that a naval war would be decided by a Mahanian clash of battleships in waters south of Japan, the planned attrition operations, submarine, air, and night torpedo attacks, were intended to sink American battleships as they advanced westward across the Central Pacific. Night torpedo strikes by high-speed cruiser-destroyer forces, the Senken Butai, or Advanced Force, were held to be the most essential component of Zengen Sakusen. The Japanese had devoted intense efforts to developing the weaponry, doctrine, and training of Senken Butai for these all-important night torpedo attacks. The fruits of their labors included first-rate night optical rangefinders and spotting sights, The skillful use of night illumination tactics, including star shells, searchlights, and flares dropped by cruiser floatplanes, and the exceptional aptitude of Japanese lookouts, chosen for their superior eyesight. In addition, the Type 93 Long Lance Oxygen Torpedo, which was 24 feet long and weighed more than a ton, carried a 1,100-pound high-explosive warhead and could travel at 50 knots to a range of 24,000 yards, or at lesser speed to a range of 48,000 yards. The long lances would inflict appalling punishment on the Allied fleet in the night to come, and in many more night actions in the ensuing campaign for Guadalcanal. Reasoning that a simple formation would reduce the risk of collisions or confusion, Mikawa arrayed his 7 cruisers and 1 destroyer into 2 columns. He placed his heavy cruisers, including his flagship, the Chokai, in the van and his destroyer in the rear. Having witnessed the annihilation of 4 carriers by air attack at Midway 2 months earlier, Mikawa knew his planned dash into the Savo-Guadalcanal area might prove disastrous. 2 or more American carriers were known to be in the vicinity, and if their air groups found him in daylight, they might destroy his ships at their leisure. Mikawa would manage the odds by traversing the last 200 miles of the run under cover of darkness, and then get away to the west before dawn. But he could not avoid being sighted farther up the slot. Allied reconnaissance flights, including a B-17 and 2 Royal Australian Air Force, RAAF, Hudson bombers, passed overhead on the morning of August 8th. Though Mikawa did not know it, his force had also been reconnoitered by an American submarine, S-38. Passing the island of Choiseul at 4 o'clock p.m., Mikawa signaled his squadron to increase speed to 24 knots for the final leg of the approach. He planned to pass south of Savo Island, shell and torpedo the transports lying off Lunga Point, turn north and attack the ships lying off Tulagi, and retreat to the north of Savo Island. He hoped to be at least 120 miles up the slot by first light. At dusk, Admiral Crutchley's cruisers and destroyers maneuvered into their night deployment positions north and south of Savo Island. In conformity to Turner's plan of operations, they divided into 2 groups, each built around 3 heavy cruisers, to guard one of 2 possible western entrances to the sound. 2 destroyers, the Blue and the Ralph Talbot, were positioned as radar pickets farther west. The main eastern entrance to Savo Sound, Sea Lark Channel, was deemed a less likely route of attack. It was left in the care of the light cruisers Hobart and San Juan. At 8 that evening, Turner summoned all senior commanders afloat and ashore to his flagship, the transport Macaulay, for a late-night conference. Though Admiral Crutchley could have traveled to the Macaulay by whaleboat, he elected to take his flagship Australia out of the southern line. In departing, he left Captain Howard D. Bode of the Chicago in command of the southern group. The northern group of commanders were not informed of the admiral's absence. On the Macaulay, Turner shared unwelcome news. He had copied a radio signal from Fletcher to Gormley, asking permission to withdraw the aircraft carriers to the east. Gormley had assented. Having previously committed to stay for 2 days, less than half the time Turner thought necessary to unload, Fletcher was now pulling out 8 hours early. Turner was dismayed, and so was the normally mild-mannered Vandegrift. Without air protection, Turner's transports and cargo ships would be vulnerable to the inevitable Japanese airstrikes on August 9th. He believed that he had no alternative but to move the rest of the fleet out at sunrise the next day. When Vandegrift insisted that he needed more supplies, Turner agreed to leave the cargo ships behind for another day of unloading. But the transports and warships must leave at dawn. At no point in the conference did Turner refer to an approaching Japanese fleet. He had received spotty and contradictory sighting reports, and apparently did not fit the pieces together. The two RAAF Hudson bombers flying from Milne Bay, southeastern New Guinea, had seen Mikawa's force that morning, but their reports had given different headings. One had identified two seaplane tenders and a column of ships on a course of 100 degrees. That misidentification, two seaplane tenders, led Turner astray. The admiral assumed they would anchor in Recata Bay off Santa Isabel Island, about 200 miles northwest, and launch seaplane torpedo attacks the following day. Turner had also assumed, mistakenly, that consolidated PBY Catalinas, flying boats, based in Espiritu Santo, had searched up the slot that afternoon. Poor weather had scrubbed those flights, but Admiral McCain had failed to inform Turner that the searches had not been completed. For that reason, perhaps, Turner had not ordered Crutchley's cruiser planes to be dispatched to reconnoiter the same area. The various communication failures and conflicting and erroneous reports seemed to have left Turner with a wholly unwarranted sense of invulnerability, at least until daylight brought the renewed threat of air attack. It was a dark and moonless night, warm and humid, with mists hanging low across the sea. Passing rain showers repeatedly shrouded the area north of Savo Island, so the northern and southern screening groups could rarely see one another. Among the Marines on Guadalcanal, rumors circulated that a major naval counterattack was impending. That impression multiplied at about 1:40 a.m., when the drone of a small aircraft engine was heard above the patchy cloud ceiling over Lunga Point. An air officer at the 1st Division command post correctly deduced that it was a cruiser floatplane, and not ours. Lieutenant Charles P. Clark, officer of the deck on the Quincy, warned the executive officer that the strange planes must be enemy, as all Allied cruiser planes had been recovered earlier in the evening. But the executive disagreed and declined to awaken Captain Samuel N. Moore. Clark later wrote that the brusque dismissal was such that I was made to feel as if I were a jittery schoolboy. According to later reports by Navy lookouts, one cruiser plane was sighted with running lights on, and therefore assumed friendly. Only one ship broadcast a warning, but it apparently did not get through to Turner. The scout dropped several parachute flares over Lunga Roads. They descended slowly through the overcast, emitting an intense greenish-yellow light that illuminated the entire transport fleet. A surge of false contact reports circulated through the marine lines. Some believed that the enemy was actually landing on the beach, and intermittent small arms fire was directed at American patrol craft offshore. Then the engines faded as the planes headed west, and the flares came to rest on the sea. The screening group crews had been at readiness condition 1 for 48 hours, and collective exhaustion was taking its toll. Rumors and bogus contact reports had continued to circulate without respite, and the contradictory and phantom sightings gradually eroded readiness. The cruisers ran in a monotonous oval pattern, crisscrossing the passages north and south of Savo Island. At nightfall on August 8th, the alert level was downgraded to condition 2, allowing half the watch to turn in and get some badly needed sleep in their bunks. The captain of one of the Allied cruisers wrote, "The enemy can reach this position at any time in the mid-watch," then went to sleep. Physical and mental fatigue had exposed the fleet to precisely the sort of surprise attack that Mikawa was preparing to spring on them. Between 12:44 and 12:54, Japanese lookouts first reported a visual fix on the destroyer Blue at a distance of about 5 miles. Mikawa ordered a slight northerly course change and cut his column's speed in order to reduce its bow waves. A few minutes later, lookouts spotted the Ralph Talbot. Both ships, which were supposed to function as the eyes of the Allied fleet, had reached the far northern and southern ends of their patrol circuits, placing them at near maximum distance from the approaching enemy column. Their lookouts did not see Mikawa's ships, and their radar sets were apparently foiled by the radar shadow of Savo Island's volcanic cone. At least a dozen Japanese guns were trained on the Blue, and the little destroyer would have been.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.